Bro, we used to argue, like, we used to have arguments, like, of who was the best superhero, you know, and you know what I mean? Like, early on, people, oh, Superman, or is it Batman? We was like, hell no, Shaft could whoop that dude in the pantyhose. He'll whoop his ass easily, you know. Right? That's how we thought. Could you feel the impact on the black community at that time, playing that role?
Constantly reminded of it, and I won't share that long story, but I had an experience at LAX coming through TSA or PSA.
TSA.
And this guy was watching me. And as I got through, he said, "Could I have a word with you?" He says, "I'm from Alabama, and as a kid, we had to sit up in the balcony, and because of watching that film, made me strive for something more than Alabama." Uh-huh. And he was in charge at the LAX. And then those type of stories I've heard all of these years, and people will come up to me and say things like that. That's I'm very proud of that.
Yeah. Okay, man. We're proud of you, man. I can't believe we got you here right now, too, right? Okay.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, October 7, 2021. So I have been told. This is our weekly book club. We are all done with Woody Allen's Apropos of Nothing. Woody, moving on to a new book, the audio that we heard at the beginning, interview segment just from a couple years back from Sway in the Morning, Victim of White Supremacy, his regular show that's been on for some years at this point. They had Richard Roundtree on as a guest, also a black male. And this was right around the time of the release of the 2019 version of Shaft. And you heard Mr. Roundtree talking about the impact of the films, plural, Shaft, going all the way back to 1971, 50 years. And just, I thought it was so important before we begin the reading to include, hey, these films starting in 1971 at a time where it was not common to have Kanye West, Barack Obama, Michelle Obama gallivanting on television every other hour. 50 years ago, that was not common at all. So for that time, I could see how many, many, probably millions of black people seeing Shaft would have a huge impact for some of them, constructive, maybe to inspire them to be to have bigger aspirations and to try to fight against racism, white supremacy. We have to look for other types of influences and impact of the 50-year film franchise known as Shaft, which all started from Ernest Tidyman, white man, his book, Shaft. And Mr. Tidyman is also the co-writer for the screenplays, plural, of at least the first two films, the Shaft film franchises, 1971 and then again 1972. So I wrote it all over social media. They didn't have any interruptions in service today. Ask your parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, if you have older folks in your family or neighborhood, ask them, did you see Shaft? Many of them, I suspect, was, of course. Did you know that the Shaft franchise, all the way back from the beginning, Richard Roundtree, was based on the book written by a white man? Not that they read the book, just did they know the origins go back to a white man who incidentally won an NAACP Image Award for creating the character John Shaft. R. Kelly won the same award. Anywho, we had options for other books to read next, but I just thought, man, Woody to Shaft. Woody to Shaft. It just seems so correct. And this is a short book, so we can hit it and quit it. And this book is also set in New York. We just spent all that time with the icon of New York City, so we're not even changing geographic location. And Woody Allen had all that homoeroticism in the text that we just read, him salivating over black male jazz musicians and saying he wanted to be an African-American jazz musician. He didn't just want to be a jazz artist. He wanted to be an African-American jazz musician. And him salivating over black male basketball players for about a half century is what, more now, closer to 100 years, really. We'll go right from that to Shaft, written by a white man. Now, that would be enough homoeroticism right there. A white man writing an entire series, like six novels, and then he participated in at least two of the screenplays and pitched a comic strip. All of this, a white man writing about Black Shaft, who is a sex machine. Lots of homoeroticism. Just pay attention as we go. Keep that in the forefront of your mind. Homoeroticism. White males. Sexual gratification with black males. Maybe that's what this whole franchise is about. Keep that in mind. Let's see. Oh, my goodness. There'll be so many opportunities to talk about comparisons between the book and the film, differences. The white man himself, Mr. Tidyman, who is a former journalist at the New York Times and the Cleveland Plain Dealer. Mr. Tidyman said that Shaft's character was neutered going to the screen. Now, I'm using the word neuter, but I mean that would be the word. He said that they robbed him of all of his politics and stance. The Shaft that we're going to read about in the book is a little bit different. I think this Shaft might even be a Vietnam veteran right alongside Geronimo Pratt. All of that was removed from the film. That'll be something to think about, but keep that in mind. Major differences between the film and what we're reading. One of the enormous differences is there's no Isaac Hayes in the book. One of the greatest soundtracks of all time, certainly one of the greatest title tracks for a movie of all time. His work, he composed and performed all of the music with assistance, of course, but I mean, he used, I think, almost exclusively black musicians to compose all of this legendary work. In fact, Isaac Hayes, with this soundtrack, became the first black person to receive an Academy Award for their work on a major motion picture film soundtrack, alongside greats like, later on, like decades later on, 3-6 Mafia for It's Hard Out Here for a Pimp, the Terrence Howard classic Hustle and Flow. Remember that one? They also got an Academy Award. So that's something maybe to keep in mind, too. When white people give black people some kind of an award, period, in this case, an award for their musical work on a film, pay attention. But Isaac Hayes became a huge part of the Shaft franchise and the legendary music and everything. Incidentally, you'll see Ernest Tidyman's name twice as the Shaft music is rolling. When the first film comes out and Shaft is jaywalking in the middle of New York, his name is flashed twice, once for the novel and then again for the screenplay. All of that notwithstanding, I'm excited to get started. The word for this book is homoeroticism. Ernest Tidyman's Shaft, and it's narrated by Will Dixon, who I suspect, and I could be wrong, you can't tell from voice, but I suspect this may be a white person. I've been trying to find images online. He's a part of the skeleton crew. I think it is so appropriate. And I'm so thankful. I was looking to see if we had volunteers who could read, and they would have been black people. No. We so needed this to be narrated by a white man voicing almost exclusively black characters, because that's what this is, the work of the white man, Ernest Tidyman. Oof. We will hear a little bit of Isaac Hayes to get started. and then we will move right to the text. Context of White Supremacy. This is audio segment number one. Dynamite Books presents Shaft by Ernest Tidyman, narrated by Will Dixon of the Skeleton Crew. Shaft 1. Shaft felt warm, loose, in step as he turned east at 39th Street for the truncated block between 7th Avenue and Broadway. It had been a long walk from her place in the far west 20s. Long and good. The city was still fresh that early. Even the exhaust fans of the coffee shops along the way were blowing fresh smells. Bacon, egg, and toasted bagel smells into the fact of the gray spring morning. And he had been digging it all the way. Digging it, walking fast, and thinking mostly about the girl. She was crazy. Freaky beautiful. And crazy. They went out to dinner, and she was wearing a tangerine wig, a long purple coat that looked like a blanket on a Central Park plug pulling one of those creaky carriages. It was the mood she was in, and he had become a part of it. They never got back to his apartment. She wanted a night like that. They had it, and then about 7:30, she handed him a glass of cardboard container orange juice and began pushing him out of the apartment. It was their night, but it was the maid's day. "Please, John, hurry." Sitting on the edge of the bed, tying his shoes. "Hey, you think that cleaning lady give a shit about your morals? All she has in her head is 12 a day and tokens. Just go, hurry." He hurried. He went. It gave him time to kill. There was no point in turning back towards the village and his own apartment. His clothes were fresh. He had hardly worn them except to dinner. The subway or cab would have been too quick for the trip to Times Square, so he walked. A big black man in a gray, lightweight wool suit, moving quickly through the morning. The light at 39th and Broadway caught him. He paused for a moment at the corner. The garment district trucks were beginning to roll into the area. Shaft watched them and glanced north towards Times Square. Sitting in his office up there, staring out at it, when he had first found the rooms and moved in, a desk, a chair, a filing cabinet, and a few hopes, he had looked for a point of view, an attitude in Times Square. He failed to find it. He decided it was a giant pinball machine, the biggest goddamn pinball machine in the world. In the early morning, like now, it lay there dull and dusty. All the parts were scattered around, but nothing was working. The dime went into the slot about 6 in the evening, turning on the juice. Then the whole thing caught fire. The bumpers, bangers, and zingers lighted up, and the channels and traps glittered. The shimmering steel balls flashed from point to point, while the score was emblazoned across the top half of it with shrieking glare. If it had a mystique, he thought,
That was it. A big, irresistible pinball machine. You'll steal some more money from your mama's purse. We'll hit 4 million this time and win a free game. That was its point of view, its attitude. And he liked it. It suited his needs for a temporary place. Shaft began to pick up its vibrations as he waited for the walk sign to flash green permission for the crossing. All that up Broadway, a few blocks, had become a part of him and was waiting for him. He stepped off the curb and moved easily around the grill of a battered Dodge truck, rolling with the contained grace of a solid, muscular man who stays in balance, who can land running or at a halt, poised to run again. I love to watch you get out of bed and go to the bathroom or to the window or to the kitchen, she said against his shoulder, a flat hand across the slab of pectoral on the right side of his chest, holding him, stroking him. You uncoil like an animal coming out of a cave. He blew cigarette smoke at the ceiling. She could not see him smile. It was much too dark. Her hand moved from his chest across the flat ripple of his muscles sheathing his stomach. It must have been 5 a.m., but it didn't matter. He could always sleep. He could always die. But he couldn't always do this. Not with someone like her. The thought of her clung to him like her cologne. Shaft glanced up at the gleaming triangle of the Allied Chemical Tower at 42nd Street, then back at the driver of the cab, inching towards him, across the tattered white lines of the crosswalk. The driver's milky blue eyes were clouded, maybe from fatigue from a night of cruising, maybe with hate from a life of hacking. Honky son of a bitch. Shaft stared him down. The cab stopped inching. One of these days, he would go over to Lexington to Uncle Sam's umbrella shop and order a bamboo-looking walking stick of Swedish steel to enforce the system of forfeits and penalties for cabs. Too close to the knees, one headlight. Too close to the back, a rear window, slight physical contact, two headlights, and the windshield. And if the driver got out of the cab, the worst they could bust him for was malicious mischief. He skipped up onto the curb at 39th Street, moving north. The coat, suit, and fabric-laden trucks would turn these streets between 7th and 6th Avenue into a steel trap in the next 15 to 20 minutes. He glanced at the steel-cased Rolex, face down on the underside of his left wrist. 8:07. Too early for anything. She had made him get up, nagged him through the quick shower. The parting kiss had been perfunctory, and the push of her hand firm as he went through the door. He had a good memory, but the hardest thing in the world to remember seemed to be that he should stay away from there on Tuesday nights. For a girl with her body and her inclinations, her easiest thing seemed to be to make him forget that the maid came every Wednesday. Vibrations. He felt again the slight signal of mood, the nuance of the atmosphere that had brushed against him a block away. Shaft's bland face, an oval mask of black-brown skin, about the color of a French roast coffee bean, fell into the lines of a slight frown, and he slackened the strong march-time stride. What the hell was it? He walked his eyes up and down Broadway. Nothing. Nobody. There were three colored guys he knew standing in front of the Drago shoe shop repair, just past 41st Street, wearing green cotton smocks and drinking coffee from containers from Wayland's on the corner, or maybe from Schraff's up past 43rd. They knew him, but they had not spotted him coming. There was no one around him on the street, just a few Puerto Rican kids getting to the garment racks they would be pushing through the streets all day. Shaft did not bother to be subtle. He turned to look behind him down Broadway as it angled toward the crossing with 6th Avenue. Who called it the Avenue of the Americas outside the New York Times? At 34th Street, nothing, nobody. The cars and trucks were nondescript, one Fleetwood limousine among them hurrying someplace to pick up its passenger. The chauffeur was a chauffeur. Her seat was empty, but Shaft still had the feeling. There was something. He had felt it before. He turned quickly into 40th Street in one of the curbside telephone booths. 9675, the operator answered. Morning, Mildred. Shaft, any calls? Say, where you been all night, Mildred? Somebody's been trying to get you all night, she rattled on. I told them that you were apparently unavailable. Who? They didn't say. They wouldn't say. You know, I always try to get a name and a number. I know you do, man or woman. Man, men, two of them, I think. Any message? They said as soon as you called, you should leave a number where you could be reached. It was important. Shaft let the Cardex file of cases roll through his mind. 3 divorces, a couple of pilferaging things. One guy thought his partner was going to burn their warehouse, a couple of insurance claims in Harlem. The adjuster was afraid to go up there and handle it himself. Nothing important. Nothing anybody would want him bad enough to stay up all night trying. They didn't leave a number? Sorry. That's all right. Look, Mildred, if they call again, you still haven't heard from me, all right?
I got it.
Thanks. Talk to you later.
Oh, Mr. Shaft?
Yeah?
What does it cost to get the goods on somebody for a divorce?
Well, I don't know. Depends on who it is, how much time it takes, what kind of case the lawyer wants, just testimony, the whole works with photographs and all that. Why?
Who's it for?
Me. I think Emil is fooling around, and you're the only private detective I know. Shaft looked east up 40th Street and saw the sun reaching down over the shoulders of the big buildings, paving the street with a moment of gold. He smiled.
How old is Emil? 63, but he's got ideas.
You still can't move very fast, Mildred. I'll give you a discount. Talk to you later.
I'll tell him what you said.
She clicked off before he had a chance to protest. Poor Emil. Spending his last few years trying to lure up a miniskirt, worried about being followed by a private detective. At a discount. Poor John Shaft, trying to get his office after being pushed off an overworked mattress, wondering who had spent the night looking for him. He was glad he had not taken her to his apartment. The number wasn't that difficult to get, and he needed the night, wasting up all that tension upon her and with her. She thought he was an animal. Let her think it. He was an animal. They were all animals, together, only some of them had never rubbed raw the fat flesh of pretension. Let her think it. Let her need it. He walked. The men looked up when he went by the drago window, looked up and nodded, in the rhythm of their bristle brushes and snapping shine cloths. They nodded, but they did not smile. So they knew something. He would have to go back and find out what it was. Shaft walked to the corner of 42nd Street, slipped the second copy of the Times from the stack at the blind vendor's kiosk, turned into the door of Whalen's. Container black, no sugar. Black, no sugar. She smiled at him. The constancy of glazed donuts had shot the hell out of her smile. Apparently, they had not gotten to her circulatory system yet. She could still smile over a coffee counter at 8:15 in the morning.
Thank you. Please pay the cashier.
8 years ago, 10 years ago, he would have been waiting out on the corner when she came out with the bag full of nickels and dimes. 8 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe he would have grabbed the purse and run. Down 42nd Street, through the crowds, into the park behind the library, out onto 40th Street, and into Fifth Avenue, scooping change from his pockets, throwing the purse into the shrubbery or under the nearest trash basket, keeping New York clean, keeping himself alive. Would she have smiled at him then? Now she smiled at a tall black man in a gray suit, blue shirt with a red silk tie. He was one of the new ones now. He left a quarter tip. He couldn't help himself, even though only one of the old ones would do that, like the ones who were waiting for him with their shine cloths and brushes. John! Hey, man. Johnny! Yeah. Each of them had a greeting as he went down the line to the last of the high chairs. As far as he could get away from the garment district hustlers in their polished plastic suits and opal pinky rings. He wasn't going out of the chute and into Times Square, into the place where he expected to be, until he found out what the Drago crew knew and why they had not smiled. They were nodding. One of them would come and tell him in a minute or so.
Thank you, sir. You have a good day now.
Somebody tipped a quarter. Somebody else couldn't help himself. Looking down on those heads of men 40, 50, 60, twice the age and more of men on the high perches. It was a very simple surgical process. You cut out the heart and took off the balls and put in 2 cans of Griffin or Kiwi, 1 black, 1 brown, and you had a shine boy of 40, 50, 60.
Watch the socks, Sam.
Sam, why don't you cut off both feet at the ankles, just for the hell of it? Then he won't need socks, will he? Sam, do you hear? Chef punched the fold of the Times into a rigid rectangle that would stand against his knee while he pried the top of the coffee container and dropped it into the brown paper bag. He spilled a little coffee on his right pant leg, the drippings from the cap. It wouldn't stain. The suit was dark, and it was the sugar and milk that stained. He began going over each headline before he started reading any of the articles. He learned a long time ago that Times readers had to do this. Otherwise, you lost whole events, world-shaking crises, in the typographical ant's nest through which they all had to crawl each morning. He was not familiar with many newspapers, and he wondered if the Times was the only one that could hide a major event on its front page. Two of them. The voice floated up to him. He did not look from the paper to the thin, gray-haired man beginning to scrub an initial coat of black dye onto his shoes. Shaft stared blankly at the page. Want to know where they might find a man who's so hard to find? Fast. Told him to find him fast. The man began to hum when one of the customers returned from the cash register's desk after paying for the shine and dropping a dime into the old man's hand. He stood with the hand outstretched, the dime standing in lonely relief against the polished stains and calluses, a grain of sand on a sea of wrinkles, as the green suit hurried towards the door. Thank you, sir. The others broke up. Over the half-shined, almost buffed shoes down the line, they made the point of scorn for the cheap-ass Charlie. Some of these days, one said. He gonna give you 15 cents to make your whole day. The dime went into the flat fold of the pocket on the green dye-spotted smock. I'll have a building fall on that motherfucker. That's gonna make my day. He played the scene, turned back to Shaft's plain-toed Oxfords. Do they know me? Sound like it. Law? Uh-uh. Who? Uptown. Uptown. Uptown, to this man, was north of 110th Street in the perimeter of Central Park. Uptown was Harlem and the shadow civilization sealed off by the Great Wall of Fear. Shaft flipped the paper open to the editorial page with big, strong, and meaty hands, broad across the pink palms, heavily veined on the back. Across the right hand was a twin track of saddle-stitched scar. It was a precise match and a continuation of the inch-and-a-half track moving down his forehead towards his eyes. A few people noticed that the hand and the head tracks connected. Women did, in bed. In the good afternoon light, when they were appraising what they had discovered, he would raise his hand to his mouth with a cigarette, and they would see the tracks connect. If he knew them well enough, he might explain how the bicycle chain had come whipping out of the vortex of a street fight, and his hand had gone instinctively to his eyes. If the hand had not moved so swiftly, well, perhaps his eyes would not be there to search her own, to move across her body and compare the color of her breast areolas with the color of his fingers upon them. Where had it happened? I might ask. Uptown, he said. It happened uptown. I was trying to kill this cat, and he didn't think I should do that. I was trying to kill myself, and he was helping me. Shaft looked at a Reston column and said softly, Do I know them? You should. Shaft could not press the old man. He had to let him play his own part in the communication conspiracy that existed between them. It was a way of giving value to the information and to the man. But it was slow. A circuitous grinding of the kernels of inference and implications into a fact on which he might act. That somebody was after him was secondary. They were coming, one way or another. It was why that counted. And something about the motivation had stiffened the context of his relationship with these men in the shine parlor. It was an indirect threat, but still a threat. Mob? Not they kind. The old man nodded toward the Italian manager and head shoemaker at the rear of the shop. Uptown, Shaft was saying it to himself. Uptown, the old man echoed, finishing the glittering shine, tapping the soles of Shaft's shoes in the traditional signal. Shaft climbed down with long-legged fluidity, paid the cashier 35 cents for the shine, tipped the old man a quarter, and handed him the Times. He would find the $10 bill spread out across James Reston's remarks about Nixon when he took the paper into the toilet or some other place of momentary privacy. Shaft would take the $10 and maybe the price of the shine back from whomever had made it necessary. One way or the other, it was like that. He took the wide, deep, dark glasses from the breast pocket of his jacket and slipped them over his eyes as he walked toward the thick glass door, stopped there for a moment to resettle the gray straw hat on the center of his forehead. His hand was on the glass, already beginning to push as the plain green Plymouth pulled up tight against the curb and the driver turned a flat, dull face towards the shop. Shaft couldn't connect the name, but he knew the face, the 17th Precinct face. Even behind the reflecting glass of the shades they both wore, Shaft felt their eyes lock for a moment and saw the face nod to him. He was supposed to walk over to the Green Plymouth while everybody in the Drago Shine line was digging it and talk with the man. Fuck him and anybody else who tried that shit. Shaft pushed the door, stepped out onto the sidewalk, and turned north in a quick spin, ready to run. First it was strangers in the night, now it was the police. What the hell was going on? That he had to know about before he talked with any of them. He was not going in blind. Johnny! Shaft let the call from the car bounce off his back. He picked up the speed of his stride. Left. He'd fall into the morning traffic pushing down Broadway now. Let the bastards blow their horns. Let the 17th Precinct watch him through the rearview mirror. There were three honeycomb buildings on 42nd between 7th and 8th that he could get into and out of fast, ducking a tail. He could get someplace and on the telephone to find out why he was so suddenly in demand. They were beside him just as he started to cut around the subway entrance at 42nd and across Broadway. Two more faces from the 17th. They had set him up for this. Whatever they wanted, they were working like hell to get it. They even sent a whole live lieutenant of detectives after it. He could go right through them and run, or he could stop and deal. He stopped. Shaft, said Andarazzi, tense, tight, waiting for Shaft's play. Lieutenant, you're out early. Well, it's late, depending on when you start. Okay, Lieutenant, you're out late. Andarazzi untensed. Shaft wasn't going to run. The other face beside the lieutenant's went blank, silent, waiting. The eyes were over his shoulder. Shaft figured the other was coming up from behind. Boxed. The morning swarms were disengorging themselves from the entrails of the subway, flowing around him, rubbing against them, a static little island in the flood. I want you to come back to the car and talk with me for a minute or so. Andarazzi delivered the line straight. There was no threat, no demand. It was just what he wanted in the moment. Shaft could accept, refuse, or screw up the conversation. He decided to make it as difficult as possible. He was very angry at being boxed. Why? I'll tell you when we talk. Now. In the car. Now. No. And fuck it. And all the rest of this ball-breaking bullshit. If they were going to bust him, they were going to have to do it right here on the corner. He wasn't going back past the Drago window in the quiet company of three white cops. They had given it the structure of a confrontation, not he. The big one next to the lieutenant was settling back on his heels to throw one. Good. He'd never know what hit him. Take him first, Johnny, the lieutenant said with a nod to the plainclothesman. I'm too old for you. I was thinking about the one behind me. The lieutenant smiled, but not with his teeth. He's not there. He's still in the car. I figure I got just enough time to find out. Let's talk, Shaft. The lieutenant had a thin gray face and black hooded eyes. He was as tall as Shaft, just under 6 feet, but much leaner. The way he stood made Shaft think of sharp objects. The lieutenant looked like a linoleum knife, ready to cut. The big beak of a nose made it complete. We're talking. Not here. Look, Lieutenant. You want to tell me something? Tell me. You want to ask me something? Ask me. You want to talk with me? Call me at my office, and we'll make an appointment, and we'll talk. We'll talk all night if you want. But not you, not him. And he better know I'm going to break it off in him and make him eat it, and not the guy behind me. None of you is going to push me in that car back there unless I know why we're going, where we're going, and how long we're going to. And somebody else, somebody on my side, maybe, knows that I'm going. Hey, take it easy, John. Take it easy, my ass. I'm taking it the way it's being fed to me right now and giving it right back to you. Look, Lieutenant, the cop started to say, shut up. He was a big piece of cheese. Andarazzi was the knife. Go back to the car. Take stupid there with you. The detective did as he was told. Shaft could feel the threat behind him melt away. All right, John, we'll talk here. The lieutenant did not look around or concern himself about who might overhear. He was looking one way, Shaft was looking the other. Between them, they probably knew every face in the city, black or white,
that should not be a party to the conversation. All right. They've been looking for you all night. Uptown, downtown, even in the village. How the hell you got way up here without running into them? I don't know. I walked. That's probably it. Only you and about 8 other crazy bastards in this city walk anywhere. Sometimes I run. Hey, so do I. Right now I got instructions to run like hell until I find out if they want you for something I should know about. The lieutenant waited. Go ahead. I want it straight, John. I have to know what's going on. What do you think's going on? Lieutenant Victor Andorazzi, head of a special investigative detail assigned to the 17th Precinct in the name of and under the sole order of the Commissioner of Police, sighed. He took Shaft's arm and started to walk with him around the corner of the drugstore, down 42nd Street towards 6th Avenue. Two men walking arm in arm as scholars might walk through the Sorbonne. You know, John, 30 years ago, I used to go upstate fishing with my old man. I loved fishing. Sitting on a little leaky boat, the old man let me bail it with a can, catching bluegills, sunfish, perch, catfish once in a while. I used to love fishing. Now I hate it. I can't stand the thought of it. I think that for the last 23 years, I've been doing nothing but fishing inside people. I've come up with the goddamnedest collection of tin cans, old tires, and other pieces of garbage. Two fags walked by, heading towards the men's room and the 24-hour movie grindhouses between 7th and 8th. They smiled at the way Andorazzi was holding Shaft's arm. They stopped smiling when Andorazzi glanced at them with the knife of his gray face. I hate it, but here I am again because somebody says I gotta go fishing trying to find out what's beginning to bite at the bottom of a very dark lake. Sometimes you get poetic, Vic. They stopped at the Wurlitzer window and looked at the black and brown pianos for $10 down and 2 lifetimes of payments. Don't get cocky. I talked to my kids just like this before I beat up on them. I'm not one of your kids, and you're fishing. I'm fishing. Would you believe me if I said I didn't have the vaguest goddamn idea what's going on, except that somebody has come down from Harlem and spent the whole night looking for me? Would you believe that's all I know? I guess I would. Then that's what I'm telling you. I'm also asking, what the hell is this? Let's go over to that nut joint on the other side and get some hot cashews. I love the things. They give me heartburn, but I can't stop. They were across 6th, turning towards the Nuts to You shop, when Chef asked, are you walking me away from Times Square? The lieutenant did not reply. He bought Shaft a quarter pound of natural pistachios, got his own cashews, then walked him across the street to Bryant Park, where the winos sleep and the fags prowl behind the backs of the almost complete works of civilization in the Marble Library. There was an empty bench that early in the day. Something has happened. The way I get it, that has turned on the gas under the kettle up there. He was popping hot cashews in his mouth, chewing, swallowing, and talking all at once. We don't know what, but something. Black cops, white cops, cops up there and down here. They have been hearing things. All kinds of things about the mob, the Muslims, the old bunch, the militants. Christ, everybody. You never saw so many cops who were hearing things. He paused for 2 cashews, then a third. And you never saw so many scared cops. Well, they're here. That something has happened to cut it all up and to set it all off. That the whole goddamn thing is going to turn into the biggest war, criminal, racial, or any name you want to give it, that this city has ever seen. That in the next week or so, there's going to be blood on every street in the city. That is what they hear. Wee, Shaft whistled. But why? I don't know, goddammit, I don't know. But you're the one who should. Some people from up there are suddenly looking for you so hard that they spread the word all over town where even my 12-year-old daughter could pick it up and report it home with it. I want to know why. I have been told, very definitely, that I must know why immediately. Shaft thought about it. War. There was no faction in Harlem ready for a war. Not now. Not yet. Some of them might want it. Lust for it with all that encapsulated violence it was possible to pack into a man. They exploded in sorties and skirmishes. They released their fury in warnings and threats. But they did not come to the point. Not yet, when it was open bloody war. On anything. Or anybody. Well, it's probably going to come one day, Shaft said. Don't test me. There is a revolution going on in this city and every other city. I know it, even if I'm just a cop. Or maybe because I'm Andorazzi and not somebody else. That's one thing, that revolution. This is another. This is what has been fermenting for the last 48 hours, not for a century. This is what may be happening tonight, not in the next week, the next month, the next year. This is what they are going to be carrying into the emergency rooms in wicker baskets about 3 o'clock tomorrow morning. You want me to have a philosophy? I do. My philosophy is to see that it doesn't happen now, whatever it is. Shaft flicked pistachio shells into the bushes and looked around the park. Andorazzi was right. For Andorazzi, everybody was right for himself. Truth is subjective. It is also negotiable. What do you want from me? If you don't know anything now, I'll settle for a call. Andorazzi pushed back the sleeve of his brown sports jacket to his watch, a thin gold circle with a gold mesh band. In about 12 hours, that's 9 tonight, I'll hear from you. One thing. Why not? The guy behind me, he isn't there. Or anywhere. You'll be able to tell. Talk to you later. Talk to you. Shaft left the lean gray man feeding nuts to a gray squirrel. He cut across 42nd Street at the light and began moving up the east side of 6th Avenue, catching the reflections in the windows of the stores, the tobacco shop, and the watchmaker. There was nothing behind him, just the 9 o'clock crush of leaky paper bags attached to people. He tuned them out. They were not part of his morning. He had been hunted, threatened, boxed, and lectured through a 60-minute kaleidoscope in which he was the dominant crystal. Yet he had been almost entirely without control over the changing patterns or the infusion of light. There had been better mornings. He felt as if he were being asked to walk across an empty stage under the blinding beam of an arc light, while an auditorium of hostile strangers judged performance in which he had been given no rehearsal. God damn, the whole bunch of them. What was he supposed to do? A tap dance on the head of a pin while they threw Molotovs at him? Shaft moved across 6th at 43rd and walked up to the electronics gadget and equipment shop. Fisher, Bogan, Gerard, three choices. He had three choices. He could hole up in the village until he found out why. He could make the rounds, make the connections until they ran across each other, and maybe it was cool and maybe it wasn't. He could go after them, run them down, and make them pay for the morning. He liked that idea, his anger rising to meet it, a gut twist of warmth. He opened the gate of it just a little, wider, caught it, and shaped it into a small ball of energy, fuel. He would burn just a little at a time. It was all he needed, just enough to get across the message that when you wanted John Shaft, you sought his attention politely, in the proper manner, with the respect he merited as a man. You didn't make trouble for him. You didn't come clumsy, tough, and evil into his place and try to make it yours, to run it your way. You knew what you were doing every minute, or he was going to show. John Shaft was going to teach you some manners. He chose 46th Street and turned west, a little more slowly now. Every face that passed him on the street became a deposit of his memory bank. The cars pushing east against the first morning traffic jam went through his search. One of the public entrances to his building was halfway down the block. The other one was around the corner, north, fronting on Times Square. He knew of three others, one out back, the fire exit, one through the shoe shop on the corner, and this one through the little store that sold the sex books over the counter and off the racks, the packets of photographs under the counter and out of the pocket, the 46th Street branch library of the Times Square foyer. The operator of the store looked up from the register and the small counter, nodded, and said nothing. Shaft had been that route before. The men at the racks flicked through the pages, studied the introductions, never looked up. It was the one place in the world where nobody looked up into the eyes of anyone else. No faces, no eyes, only into the books and the fantasies. Shaft slipped down
one of the tight aisles to the rear, and the door marked no entrance, employees only. He pulled it open and stepped into a long, narrow corridor, moving quickly past the open doors of a small office, a storeroom, a toilet, 20 feet down the dark hallway to the door at the end. He turned the latch of the triple bolt lock, eased it open a crack, and looked into the building's stairwell, hallway. Empty. He ducked into a crouch to move out. The door in the stairwell leading into the lobby was half glass, half steel. He started to go for the stairs, then turned to the lobby door, holding himself flat against the gray, dusty wall to peek out. The elevator starter was ushering the morning arrivals into the cars. Some office girls were stopping at the magazine cigar stand for cigarettes and chewing gum. And there was one of them. The son of a bitch. Shaft could hardly believe it. Did they still make them that way? The tall, angularly thin Negro wore a double-breasted brown suit two sizes too large, large enough to get a .38 in the belt without a bulge, or maybe something smaller or bigger. Standing in front of the book rack, probably worrying the counterman about whether some of his cheap volumes were about to be lifted. Probably worrying everybody who came through the rundown, unpolished lobby en route to the offices of second-rate lawyers, small show business types, a couple of novelty merchandise jobbers, and John Shaft investigations. Standing with one eye on the book rack and the other on the lobby. Dumb. John Shaft would come through the lobby, get on the elevator, and this one would step quickly after him. A very simple box. The one upstairs would help him tie the ribbon on it when they got up there. The stupid son of a bitch. Shaft eased open the door, stepped into the lobby, and paused. It was about 10 steps to the man's back. Shaft waited for the elevator to start to pack in another load and turned towards the entrance. All he needed was, "Good morning, Mr. Shaft," that's all. The starter saw the doors closed and turned. Now Shaft moved. Now she could have called him animal and known what it meant. 10 steps. He took it in 4 swift strides. As the ball of his left foot touched down on the last of them, his right hand came up, palm down, fingers welded together and straight out like a spear. He drove it exactly 8 inches, thrusting into the relaxed flesh of the slender sentinel, just at the kidney, slightly behind and below the rib cage. Flesh, muscle, tissue tore beneath the thrust. "Ah!" the man gasped. Then the pain took him out, and he began to fold like a marionette whose strings had been slashed. Shaft threw an arm around his waist, one hand finding the outline of the gun beneath the coat, and held him up. Marty, at the cigar counter, kept handing chewing gum to Stanos. "Hello, Jimmy," Shaft said to the elevator starter. "Good morning, Mr. Shaft. Say, what happened to a friend of mine? Has fainting spells. Let me get him up to the office for a drink of water." Pour water into this one, and it would come out blood for a long time. "Sure thing, Mr. Shaft. Just a minute, folks. Man's sick here. Take the car. Go ahead." Shaft pushed the button for the third floor, tore the gun out of the sagging waistband, and stuck it into his right rear pocket. 45 revolver? Colt's old army model. It was insane. What did they think this was, 1932? Insane. He dragged the crumpled rag doll out of the car at the third floor and straight down the hallway to his own office door. Some typewriters were already going behind the others. There would be people off the next car in a few seconds. He propped his wheezing burden against the wall directly opposite the entrance to his office, knocked sharply, and stepped aside. "Hey, what the hell?" said the head that poked out of the door and stared for a moment of surprise. A moment in which the guillotine of Shaft's arm descended. It took the head just behind the left ear. He had them both inside before the sick thwack had echoed around the corner and down the hall to the nowhere of silence. Shaft pushed a finger at the collection on top of the desk blotter. They had to be out of their minds. Or to want him so badly that recklessness of this sort was not a consideration. A black cannon of a .45 gleaming with the oil of attention and care, as big as a giant turkey leg next to the nickel-plated .38 from the pocket of the other. Nobody carried heat like that into Times Square. Nobody but a maniac looking for a president to kill. With a couple of long-bladed knives and a nasty little gadget, that burlier of the two, the one that had been in his office, probably made himself. A piece of industrial belt or strap studded with a brass screw head, and 2 ends of the strap forming a loop where they attached to a 3-inch length of lead, about 1 inch in circumference. The loop went over the fingers and around the knuckles while the hand closed on the lead cylinder. A short, hard blow with that would tear a man's jaw off. It could kill and cripple. It might have killed and crippled him if he had not been so clumsy and stupid. Shaft looked at them, propped against the wall beside the desk. The skinny one was wheezing and groaning with the agony of his torn kidney, the other silent and unconscious, while a small trickle of blood wandered down the side of his chin like a country road on a black topographical map. Shaft's own stomach muscles were clutched in the spasms of tension. Anger and so much adrenaline was pouring through his system that he felt the soaring capacity to do anything, anywhere, to fling open the window and run up the side of the building to the 20th floor before gravity noticed he was gone. But he gave no sign of it. His hand was completely steady as he shook a Kent from one of the packages he had scooped out of their pockets, along with the armament, the wads of $10 bills both had been carrying, keys, and a miscellany of matches, coins. No wallets, no identification, no names. The match flared, and he drew deeply and swallowed the smoke, letting it trail out his nose. Waiting, calming down, he began flipping through the mail that had been pushed through the slot at the door. A couple of ads for office services. A letter from the Pinkertons asking if he could make himself available again for an assignment as night porter at Bergdorf Goodman to deal with the pilferage problem. A couple weeks' work as an anonymous black face. The rate was good, but it screwed up his social life. A letter from Damrosch, Pinnott, and Sullivan, attorneys at law, including a check for $756.22 for services rendered to a client who is now free to remarry and provide more employment for lawyers and private detectives, if not to mention motel clerks. Shaft put the check in his wallet, making a mental note to send it to his accountant, Marvin Green. An almost indecipherable postcard from somebody in Athens. Who the hell did he know, making the scene in Athens? The name was either Josie, Josiah, Joseph, or Josh, and none of them meant anything. He threw it in the square green metal wastebasket. Nothing much, nothing to worry about. He pulled over the desk calendar. Nothing there either. It was, as he recalled, to be a day to clean up odds and ends. Maybe go looking for some new furniture for the office. It depressed him in its simple, uniform plainness. Anybody who came into the office probably thought of used furniture first and Shaft second. It needed a taste of dignity, class. He was going to run over to the Itkin showroom and see a guy who could deal a discount later. He could do it later. It would not make that much difference. The immediate and sole problem he had was there on the floor beside the desk. Half of it was moving, slightly groaning, and coming back to consciousness. Shaft reached for the .45, hefted it in his hand, and flipped open the cylinder with a thumb flick of the catch and a shake of his wrist. All six chambers loaded. The stupid bastard didn't even know enough to keep the firing pin on an empty chamber. Drop the piece one day, it lands on a hammer and accidentally blows your ass off. It infuriated him anew that the estimate of his presence, if not his importance, should be so lightly made that clowns like this would be sent to seek him out. He glanced out the window. The day was clearing up. It would be breezy, bright, and sunny, he thought, pulling back the hammer on the 45. The big one began blinking. Maybe the noise of the steel clicking into place on the big gun in Shaft's hand had cut through the murk of his confusion. Shaft watched the man's eyes roll, shift left and right, and come into focus. Shaft fixed them by raising the gaping muzzle of the pistol and pointing it directly at the flat, flaring nose between those eyes. They locked on the barrel, then lifted to Shaft's own. There was no fear there, but hatred, so raw and violent that Shaft wondered what his own face might be reflecting. "What do you want?" Shaft demanded. The other just looked at him, raising the back of his left hand slowly to wipe away the blood on his chin, then glancing down at it. Finally, he said, "Man, I'm going to kill your ass." Shaft pushed his chair back with his left hand, kept himself in a low-leaning crouch, and held the gun straight out and steady. His finger on the trigger was less than a hair, less than a feather. But it was there, and the man on the floor could see it. Shaft reached over with his left hand to the skinny one, crumpling the grotesquely wide lapels of the double-breasted brown suit in his fist. He moved back, raising the gangling form with him, staying in the crouch, keeping the gun steady and aimed. Then he spun and whipped. Every taut muscle of Shaft's body went into the twist and the turn, the wrench of his arm and the lash of his wrist. The limp, bent form in brown danced, skated, and angled crazily through the open space between the desk and the window. The glass exploded against the head and shoulders of the projectile. It crashed and clattered and tinkled as the body went hurtling through and out into the bright, breezy, sunny spring day. He had not moved the gun more than 6 or 8 inches. The eyes locked on it began to fill and bulge with fear as the last shards of glass sprinkled the pavement and the screams of shock and horror rose from the sidewalk. Tires chewed noisily into the asphalt. Car and truck horns exchanged insults with the buses, and the wind ruffled the papers on Shaft's desk. His voice sounded almost casual, cool, but the tone of it cut through the wave of noise as a dark dorsal fin cuts through the night sea. "Gonna kill my ass, huh?" The man on the floor was turning into 200 pounds of chocolate pudding in a blue suit. Rivulets of perspiration ran down his face, dropped onto a yellow tie. "Well, you got 2 minutes, maybe. 2 minutes before they come up here and ask me why I threw that son of a bitch out the window. Then the man is going to ask me why I shot you right through the head. You hear? Right through the fucking head, like he was the worst kind of dog in the world. You hear?" The first siren was keening toward Times Square. "You hear that? That's the meat rag from the morgue coming to take you home. So now you answer me. You answer me straight. And maybe you got 2 minutes, maybe a minute and a half, and maybe I'll listen." The man began to stammer and blubber.
Knox said we was to get you and bring you. Knox said you was to come up and talk with him. Knox said he didn't care that you was to..."
Shaft gazed at the man and listened, but his mind was moving off. A vision of Knox's persons began filtering through it, a vision of gargantuan proportions, of glittering automobiles, flashing diamonds, number runners, pushers, hustlers, the smoky, seedy bars of side street Harlem. They moved through the vision too, becoming a part of the conglomerate Knox Pearsons. The man on the floor had nothing more to tell him. This was just an errand boy with a screw-studded lead-weighted fist and chrome-glittering .38 to help him tie up the packages. Shaft was insulted. Send a boy to fetch a boy. He heard the commotion developing in the corridor outside the offices, and he considered pulling the trigger. Squeeze it off right into the middle of the furrows of fright that covered the wet, ugly face. But he would never get the wall clean, and he hated the sinus corroding fumes of fresh paint. And why bother? Knox Pearsons would get the message from the fallen pigeon being scraped off the pavement below.
Context of White Supremacy. So that is the first audio segment from Shaft. We'll pick up right at the beginning of chapter two. Unlike apropos of nothing, this book does have chapters. Number to dial, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. If you have any folks out there, if you've seen any of the Shaft films, the more recent one, 2019, all the way back to 1971, many, many offerings over that 50-year run, let us know. Did you know that this franchise was based on a book written by a white man? This here book is pretty close to the movie's beginning. Even has Shaft jaywalking in the middle of the road at the beginning of it, and him tipping the shine black fella $10, it's pretty close to the beginning of the 1971 Shaft offering. But number again, 720-716-7300, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com, untiljustice@gmail.com. Let's see, I'll get one email, and then I'll get to some of the folks who dialed in. I posted on social media and other places earlier in the day. If you have grandparents, aunts, uncles, whatever, you and your parents, really, depending on their age and what have you, ask them, did you see Shaft at any point in your life? And if they say yes, did you know these movies were based on a book written by a white man. Just to see what they say. Let's see. First person who wrote in, let's see, one of our investors, chapter one, the thought of her clung to him like her cologne. I thought the word cologne is more associated with male fragrances in most people's minds, as opposed to perfume being more associated with women. I may be overthinking this. I thought the same thing. Even now, this was 50 years ago, but I think even then they had perfume. The word perfume was used. I don't think that's that new to our lexicon. I generally see cologne used to refer to males, male fragrances. Number two, referring to the shoeshine workers, took off the balls. Interesting reference to castration and emasculation by the white male author. If you look at, there are a series of books that Tidyman wrote on Shaft. One of them is Shaft Among the Jews. I posted that image earlier today, and then he has another one. Shaft has a ball. Shaft's big score. Sometimes they'll use the word score to mean that someone engaged in sexual intercourse. I scored, had sexual intercourse with a female. Sometimes they'll say that. So lots of interesting word usage throughout these titles. Number three, the suit was dark, and it was sugar and milk that stained. Reads to me like a symbolic reference to semen. Could be. Number four, Lieutenant Andarazi took Shaft's arm, two men walking arm in arm, two fags, smiled at the way Andarazi was holding Shaft's arm. Is there an inference that Shaft is conflicted about his sexuality? Keep that in mind. Get back to that scene later. Number five, the black cannon of a 45 gleaming with the oil of attention and care as big as a giant turkey leg. Dr. Welsing would have much to say about this passage, about this entire book. This is another one. I'm like, man, Dr. Welsing, did you know? Like, I would think, of course you did. Like, did you read this book, or do you even have thoughts on a white man making a whole book called Shaft? He has more commentary to say, but we haven't got that far in the text. Let's see. Folks who dialed in, star 61, if you have commentary to share. Let's see. Retired firefighter, see your hand. I'll nab other folks as I see hands.
Greetings, Gus. Greetings to everyone. No, I wouldn't have any way to know that a white person had anything to do with the Shaft origins. And at the age of 14, probably didn't care either. At that time, and everyone that was around me socially did not have any idea. At that point in time, there wasn't a whole lot of scientific input into understanding racism, white supremacy, as the opportunity of it being today. I'm specific on by saying the opportunity of racism, white supremacy, to be more scientific. It does with the technology that's around now, you can be much more scientific, much more investigating on the bottom line of things. And I would say there is more of an interest now than what it was back in 1971. That was one of the movies of its type that actually was encouraged for black teenagers to go and watch. And for me, it was to board several buses along with a whole cadre of black male friends and go downtown Miami to see the movie. It was advertised on the black listened radio station in the form of, if you want to go see Shaft, ask your mama. And that was because it was R-rated movie. Although they really didn't check on the age of anything. If you look like you were 17, 16, 17, 18, whatever it was, then, you know, nobody said anything. You went and watched it. The reading is very similar to the beginning of the movie itself. The writer was correct on that. One thing that I noticed that is kind of like outdated in today's time, the whole idea about the shoe shining is not as popular anymore. I think because sneakers have actually surpassed shoes, hard surface shoes, especially for young people. About the only time young people have interest in hard sole shoes is when they get put in a casket. And let alone talking about the difference in prices, you know, sneakers back during that time only cost about maybe $10-$12, and those were the ones that the NBA players wore, called Converses, still at the time. Whereas now you're talking about $200 for a pair of sneakers. But I think shoe shining kind of like went out of business, so to speak. I imagine it may be some, but it's not nearly as much as it was back in 1971, especially in a large metropolitan city such as Miami or New York, especially, you know, largest in the world. Yeah, those are just my thoughts. So the movie is very similar to what the reading is very similar to the movie itself so far. That's all I have to say right now. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. About going to see this at a young age, I definitely do not think this is a movie that a 14-year-old needs to go and check out. Like, man, gratuitous violence, sex scenes, several of them. Like, no reason you need to have a 13-year-old, 14-year-old going to see Shaft, in addition to other things we will get to as well. Much obliged, our caller in Florida. And that's a good point as well. It's not like everybody had a smartphone at the time. You could just go and, boop, let's see what IMDb has to say about this and all that other, you know, would have been a lot more difficult to investigate, to get all the details. And the amount of what I would say is racial showcasing, there are so many black people out front of this project, you would kind of have to, you know, dig or research something to be like, oh, wait a minute, Gordan Parks directed this. Richard Roundtree is the lead actor. Isaac Hayes did the soundtrack. However, a white man hired all of them, and this book existed before all of that. And Mr. Tidyman co-wrote the screenplay. So it's not like he just had a small hand in this. He hired all of these folks. He had a production company set up before this film even existed, before Gordan Parks had been hired to direct or anything else. It would have probably been a lot more difficult to get that information back in 1971 at the time that this film came out. And this film was released on Friday, July 2nd, 1971. The book came out the year before. July 4th, weekend release. They intended for a lot of people to see this, they being white people.
Mr. Parks played briefly in it also. About, yeah. a, cameo 20 role. Second period. He was in it. Yeah.
Lots of race. And he forgot Bodini Brown.
Yes, sir.
Muhammad
he sure
Ali,
did.
Corner person.
He was one of the bodyguards. The
Rumble, sting like a butterfly, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Rumble, young man, that's Bodini Brown. He's right in the movie as well. When we get to his character, I have to pick him out. So it's a lot of, you know, very well-known black people established that, you know, played a part in this film that you have to look behind all that. And go, oh, wow. A white man hired all these folks. Now, they didn't include this at the beginning of the audiobook, but this is at the beginning of the novel, so I'll read it. Maybe should have included it first. It reads, Shaft is big. Shaft is black. The cloistered daughter of Harlem's black crime boss discovers the true nature of her father's work and runs off to be as bad as dad. Sex, liquor, dope, and a few other scenes. She is into them all when she disappears. Big Daddy wants Big Shaft to get his baby back. Shaft goes to work, and the mafia, the black militants, the NYPD, and City Hall go to work on Shaft. Now that's how all this begins. Shaft is big. Shaft is black. And then we'll hire Big Shaft to solve all this. Homoeroticism. And then chapter one, that's how the book starts. So the notes that I took from chapter one, it starts off, he's talking about, this hookup that he had with a female before. Freaky, beautiful. That's how he describes the female. Crazy. Shaft is having relations with females who are freaky, of course. Let's see. A little bit later on, so he's walking through his morning routine, walking the streets of New York, and he sees this white woman. She smiles at him. He looks at her and says, 8 years ago, 10 years ago, he would have been waiting out on the corner when she came out with the bag full of nickels and dimes. 8 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe he would have grabbed the purse and run down 42nd Street through the crowds into the park behind the library, out into 40th Street and into Fifth Avenue, scooping change into his pockets, throwing the purse into the shrubbery or the nearest trash basket. Now, in the film, at no point does Shaft talk about his previous life before being a private investigator, where he was some sort of street hoodlum, snatching purses, mugging people. There's no backstory of that at all in the movie. So, of course, Shaft couldn't have always been an upstanding citizen. He's a criminal at some point, or was a criminal. Let's see. The shoeshine scene is in the movie, and it's exactly as it's written here. He gives him $10. He gives the black male shoeshine person, gives Shaft this information. Hey, somebody's looking for you, and blah, 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 and all that. Shaft looks out for him, leaves. Incidentally, the last time I saw a shoeshine stand was when I was at the airport in Virginia, Coon Man. They did have a shoeshine set up there in Richmond, no less. Let's see. Next. They're talking about the whole, now this was mentioned too. Somebody tipped a quarter. Somebody else couldn't help themselves, looking down on those heads of men, 40, 50, 60, twice the age, and more of the men on high perches. It was a very simple surgical process. You cut out the heart and took off the balls and put in two cans of Griffin or Kiwi, one black, one brown, and you had a shine boy of 40, 50, 60.
that is not in the movie. So a little short description about how you arrive at having these shoeshine boys who are actually 40, 50, 60-year-old black males. Cut out the hearts, took off the balls, two cans of shoe polish, and there you go. System of white supremacy, racism. And this Mr. Tidyman sounds like he's not ignorant about that system, even though it's very genital focused so far. Let's see. All right, so now Shaft is talking to Andarazi, the white police officer. It's a group of them, three of them. He talks about feeling boxed. So the officer, white officer, says to Shaft, "Let's go over to that nut joint on the other side and get more hot cash and get some hot cashews. I love the things. They give me heartburn, but I can't stop." So as soon as I saw that, I'm thinking, that's a little curious. Nuts, we've had all this gentle, cut off the balls and blah, 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 and all this Shaft. Am I reading something? So I keep reading right from there. Lieutenant did not reply. He bought Shaft a quarter pound of natural pistachios, got his own cashews, then walked him across the street to Bryant Park, where the winos sleep and the fags prowl behind the backs of the almost complete works of civilization in the marble library. Now we're going to the nut shot, and then before I even get a sentence or two away from that, now we're having a conversation about so-called fags. Homoeroticism, and the person who wrote in, our investor, he was talking about how the officer grabs Shaft by the arm, so they're walking almost holding hands or arm in arm, going to the nut shack, and then to hang out where the fags hang out. Homoeroticism. This is not in the movie. Shaft goes to get heated nuts by himself, not with the police officer, and they don't go hang out at the fag spot, I don't think. However, just keep all that in mind as we move through the book. Let's see. Next. So these two guys are following him. These are two black guys. Shaft, you know, sees all this. He gets the jump on them, takes the one guy up to his office. The other guy's waiting, jumps on him. So he got this gun held out at, got them both at gunpoint, trying to figure out, you know, what are you looking for me for? The one black guy charges him. Shaft gives a quick twist, and the guy goes out the window. All this is exactly in the movie, happens exactly that way. The other black guy, he's talking to him. He says, "Going to kill my ass, huh?" And I said, homoeroticism. There it is again. You can't just be going to kill me. Going to kill my ass, huh? And so then they get into this whole thing. What are you doing here? You have 2 minutes to tell me what's going on, or the police are going to be here asking questions about why this guy went out the window. Now, even watching this in the movie, they talk about how tough and gangster and all that Shaft is. You don't see Shaft kill any white people until almost the end of the movie. Most of the people that are dying and getting beat up, even the Shaft is, you know, talking wild to and all that, are black people. These are black people that get beaten up and one killed and the other one threatened. Something to keep in mind as well as we move through the text. Let's see. Oh, that's the end of one. That's the end of one. Let's see. Any other folks, thoughts, commentary they want to make sure they share about the first audio segment? Switchboard.
I have additional if nobody else comes up.
Retired firefighter, proceed while folks get their thoughts together, perhaps.
I do recall that there was a hot nut scene. I can't remember exactly what it was. It was close to the beginning of the movie. And there also was a scene where he was eating a hot dog. I think that world famous hot dog that comes from New York. I just can't think of the name of it now. But The movie is a is was during a time when the Vietnam War has significantly changed to whereas the white people over here understood that that it was not going to work out in the way that they were saying it was, and also in the States, the different Civil Rights Act and all of those different bills and whatnot had been passed, and the 60s had courses ended into the early 70s at that time. And you had on the streets in New York, especially, a lot of war veterans who was already addicted to heroin and probably some other narcotics. And so it was a big sale. The movie Godfather also came out at the same time and told some truths about how the retail of illegal drugs was being created on a big scale in areas where black people stayed at. And that was going on at that time also. That has something to do with all of this warring that was potentially was going to take place with the what they was hinting about in the movie itself, that sort of thing. And so, I mean, of course, I wasn't that knowledgeable about that at that time as a ninth grader. But, you know, you can look back on it, you know, now and see some of the parts in the movie that actually was reality at some level. Yeah.
Much
and they had already they already destroyed the Black Panther Party by that time, too.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Folks can be mindful. Vietnam is not mentioned in the film at all. There are some loose mentions to drugs, or there are a number of mentions to drugs in the film, but no mention of Vietnam. Vietnam is going to come up specifically in the book. That's one of the things where I said, Ernest Tidyman said, man, they neutered all the politics. What happened to Vietnam and all the rest of this? How did that get moved out of the movie? So well, that's one of the things comparing contrasting differences. Let's see. Henry in Chicago should be with us as well. If you have commentary, sir.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
All right. Greetings, Gus, and greetings to all the callers and listeners. I don't have the book. I was just following the audio. I don't know if I want to purchase the book. Hopefully, I'm going to try to find it online to see if I can get it for free. I'm not interested in buying or even looking for the book in the library, if that's anything. But it's interesting, you bring up the sexual innuendos of Shaft, considering, you know, he's this, you know, black male figure who is only recognized through his masculinity by having sex with, you know, with these women. You know, whenever you think of Shaft, you think of sex machine. And this is, you know, when I was listening to the introduction, how he had sex with this woman and how this, you know, how Shaft was the best in the bed and all this other kind of, you know, stuff that, I guess the white author is trying to validate his manhood, I guess. I don't know. But I never saw the movie Shaft. I did see the one in 2000 with Samuel Jackson. And I'm pretty sure it's probably, you know, it's a little different, but, you know, probably the same theme. Because I remember even that movie, beginning of the scene, Samuel Jackson through the credits was having sex with this woman. So it's like, sounds the same to me. But it's interesting how, you know, they're trying to prop up this, the pinnacle of black manhood as just being this sex machine. But obviously a white author is writing this. But then when you were talking about how in the book while they were going to the nut shop, and if I'm not mistaken, it said that the shop's name was Nuts to You. I may be wrong, but I think that's what I heard. But there was also and you mentioned this, Gus, about the lieutenant holding Shaft's arm while while what they described as the fags watching. That sounds like, basically kind of like demasculizing him. Just basically taking away his manhood, as usual. That's how white people do. They take away black males' manhood, basically remove them from manhood at that, even though they're trying to make this guy the pinnacle of black male maleness in a real twisted way. You know, the only way you can be male is through your genitals. Obviously, the name Shaft. But I also think that I wonder if this novel, because this novel was written in 1970, and The Spook Who Sat by the Door was written a year before this. And I was often kind of like questioning, because, you know, just like you asked the question, Gus, if we knew Shaft was written by a white man. Yeah, I didn't know about this until, you know, maybe recently. I actually was looking at the Wikipedia page, and I saw the author of the book and didn't realize it was a white man. But I often wonder if this novel was written in contrast to The Spook Who Sat by the Door. But then, you know, Shaft was made into a movie the next year after the novel was published, where it took The Spook Who Sat by the Door 4 years to make. And it wasn't almost made until because Sam Greenlee, the author of the book, and Ivan Dixon, who's the director of the movie, they almost ran out of money. And I think they did run out of money before finishing up the film. So that's always a question in the back of my head with Shaft. So, but that's all I have.
Much obliged, Henry, in Chicago. That is certainly an important point in terms of Spook Who Sat by the Door, which we did read in the book club way back when, the late Sam Greenlee. But they came out at the exact same time in terms of the books when they were written, both novels, fiction, Mr. Greenlee being a victim of racism, and very different responses. This book, you know, has been valorized and made into films repeatedly, even though the book has never been that well known, which might be deliberate, who knows. But there are six, like I said, it's not just one, it's six different books in the series, I believe. It's not even like he just wrote one or two. But Sam Greenlee, the movie went out of publication. That wasn't celebrated and, oh, let's everybody go brag about this and isn't this wonderful and something to think about? No. Many, many years before that, you know, came back into circulation and people were able to see it and all that. It's on YouTube and all that now. But for a number of years, that was not the case. And that book wasn't even that readily available for some time either. So definitely could have been. And even Melvin Van Peebles' Sweet Sweetback's Badass Anthem, which was kind of viewed in the same way as kind of some militant, potentially dangerous project. You know, we don't know how much attention we want to get to that either. That came out in March. Shaft came out in June. So absolutely, I could see, because this became easily much more well known than either of those two films, Sweetback or The Spook. Let's see if we have any other folks who have comments. I believe, unless I got the email incorrect, I was able to get you a copy of the book. I can totally support anybody who does not want to purchase this white male's book. totally understandable. And this book is like 70 or 50 years old. The book is 50 years old at this point. It's not like, and he's passed away. He's been dead for a number of decades. So it's not like he's missing out on nickels. Unless folks have, oh, one more. The animal, he talks about being engaged in sexual intercourse with this white woman, unless I'm in error, I think it's a white woman. And he talks about, he has a passage where he says, I love to watch you get out of bed and go to the bathroom or window or the kitchen. She said against his shoulder, a hand flat across the slab of pectoral on the right side of his chest, holding him, stroking him. You uncoil like an animal coming out of a cave. He blew cigarette smoke at the ceiling. She could not see him smile. It was much too dark. Her hand moved from his chest across a flat ripple of muscle, sheathing his stomach. It must have been 5 a.m., but it didn't matter. He could always sleep. He could always die, but he couldn't always do this. Not with someone like her. I'm just also kind of keeping in mind how many times we're referring to Shaft as an animal and or black people in general, but just kind of keeping that in mind. A sex machine, even that, the man knot, that is not a compliment. Calling someone a sex machine, not even a person anymore. Walking phallus, that's what James Baldwin said, just a walking phallus. Unless folks have any other observations, commentary on the first, we really only read one chapter, the opening of one chapter. Any other thoughts folks need to get in? Are we pushing off to chapter two?
Haven't heard the term fag in a long time in a book. I was just thinking about that when I heard it at least twice in the first reading. Haven't heard it in a book. I can't remember the last time I even heard it in a book, let alone talking about it at all. Just a thought.
Probably a reason why you get into all kinds of trouble for saying that word now, like oof, all kinds right. of homophobes and names right. and every, especially a black person, like my goodness. Woof. Thankfully, a white person authored this. So if anyone has gripes, complaints, Earl Tidyman, his word usage. Maybe he wanted, and he even said that this was 1970, so you had the so-called sexual revolution and Vietnam and drug experimentation and all that. So I guess he wanted to kind of include some of that sort of language that was widespread at the time.
Oh, yeah, it was a popular word back then, yes.
Right on. Unless folks have any other comments that they need to get in. We will push off to chapter two. If you have additional comments or there's something that you forgot to include, make a note. We should have ample time to share once the second audio segment concludes. Picking up with Shaft by Ernest Tidyman. Again, very different experiencing this with no Isaac Hayes and a white man narrator. Will Dixon, maybe he's not white, but wow. At least my early sleuthing, I suspect that this is a white man, which is super appropriate. Context of White Supremacy, audio segment number two.
Two. The day was shot. It went out the window with that fool. It went over to the new precinct offices on East 51st Street. The homicide people got a piece of it. So did the smart-ass young assistant district attorney. Questions, answers, statements. How did he cover the lobby? The first one put an arm on him there, he said, was taking him up to the office to finish the job. Well, what did he say to you? Which one? The first one. We'll have his name in a couple of minutes. He said he was going to blow my motherfucking brains out. It was definitely a threat on your life. It was an invitation to go roller skating. Mr. Shaft, I'm trying to establish the reason why a man died this morning. Mr. Shapiro. I am only trying to tell you why he was the one who died, and I wasn't. Shaft gambled. He bet the elevator starter and the cigar stand proprietor would not want to remember how it happened. Two black men? What two black men? Got no trouble with coloreds around here, buddy. Why don't you guys chase all the winos and queers out of Times Square? Get the pigeons while you're at it. Chef bet the cops wouldn't care that much. A body in Times Square was as easy to ignore as a baboon in a ballroom. But a dead spade is a dead spade. Who in blue really gave a shit? Chef gambled. The newspaper and television reporters tried to get a piece of the day. They failed. No pictures. Chef's occupation made it necessary for him to remain as anonymous as possible, he said. He wanted to cooperate, of course, but they understood. Go take a picture of Times Square. Go interview a cop. Lieutenant Andarazzi rescued him from the energy-sucking remainder of it. He turned up late in the morning, noted that the two men who had accosted Shaft were thoroughly documented acquaintances of the law as thieves, takers and sellers of narcotics, carriers of dangerous weapons, dealers in mayhem and malevolence, and had been a considerable drain on the time and the tax dollars of the city. If anything, he suggested, they should be billed for repairs to Shaft's window. I think we'll wash, Andarazzi said, looking up from the report he had been reading to the wingtip Oxford hooked at the corner of his desk. We told the papers they were probably looking for narcotics in a dentist's office in the building. I hope there's a dentist in the building. Shaft raised his chin from his chest. He had almost gone to sleep in the butt-cupping grip of the molded steel chair. Don't know, maybe. Place has got everything else, including a couple of chicks on the 10th floor operating a tour service that will take you around the world for $50 a trip. That's nice. It gives you something to do with your lunch hours. Listen, I think this will wash, but you're technically charged with homicide. We will all have to go down to the district attorney's office and do a routine for them about what a couple of bad bastards these guys were. Black bastards? Bad bastards. Don't be paranoid. Well, you pretty fancy. I used to take night classes. The door to the small office opened, and a squarely built plainclothesman walked in carrying a slip of paper, sleeves rolled up over beefy forearms, pants bagging and sagging under the weight of the pistol in the waistband, holster, handcuffs dangling from the belt, a blackjack, and a report journal crammed into back pockets. He nodded at Shaft. Shaft nodded back. This is the number. He handed the slip to Andarazzi, turned to leave as the lieutenant got his long legs down off the desk and came to something like attention. Thanks, Tony. Yes, sir. Reporters and people all gone? About 10 minutes ago. Thanks. Andarazzi got a ballpoint out of the desk drawer and copied the number onto a scratch pad. He handed the slip to Shaft. Knox will answer, and only Knox. It's going to surprise the hell out of him. They have the lovely baritone of John Shaft coming out of it. Why? What is it? A payphone in his closet. Andarazzi laughed lightly. It's the only one he uses to call his ex-wife. About once a week, he goes into the closet and calls her. He listens to her and complain about her apartment, the clothes she needs, the money she wants, the car she just wrecked, the people who are dumping on her. Like that until the operator breaks in and says, 5 cents more in 5 minutes, please. It's a payphone, right? Knox tells her he hasn't got any change and he'll call her back later and hangs up. That's it for a week. The telephone just sits there waiting. And if it rings, he answers and explains it's a wrong number. Shaft laughed too. Most of the tension of the day had drained out of him, but he was nowhere near the free floating spirit he had felt coming up 7th Avenue that morning. A little more human now, more in touch with himself, but still not right. He got out of the chair, stretched out on the floor and began doing push-ups. How the hell did he get a payphone in his closet? Andarazzi counted 10, 11, 12, and wondered if he could still pass 10 himself. Just ask the telephone company to stick it in there. Guaranteed them the average take in dimes each month. Well, who found it? Internal revenue. Tax people were throwing a bug on every wire in and out of his place last year, and they came across this one. They crossed connections while they were hooking it up, and an operator came in and demanded that they deposit a dime. Shaft's amusement was making it almost impossible to continue. He squeezed out the 28 push-ups and got up, dusted his hands off, palm against palm. Pretty clean floor. How'd they fix the operator? Same way Persons does. Told her they didn't have any change and got the hell out of there. When they stopped laughing, Shaft asked. Tax people after Persons now. Everybody's after him. We are, they are, for all I know, the CIA is. Shaft remembered a story about the old mafioso, Frank Costello, who used to pick up his telephone each day to summon his chauffeur
and deliver a general greeting to the assorted crackles and beeps on his line. Good morning, everybody. I guess I'll split. Got to make a phone call. Want to make it here? No. One thing, John.
Yeah.
You know persons. I'm from Harlem, man, remember? Just because I live in the village, wear a beret and walk a little funny, that don't mean. Andarazzi was serious. The detective leaned over the desk on his elbows, his hands on his face, pulling the flesh away from his eyes. He looked like a skinny Halloween mask, remotely connected to the cap gun dangling in a shoulder holster beneath his left armpit. No. Have you ever talked with him or met him? Saw him a couple times, that's all. He's mean, John. Tough, ruthless, smart, cunning, and mean. I dig all that. We call it evil. He's evil in any language. Seeing him and going up against him is a whole new ballgame. 6 or 7 hours ago, you killed one of his people. I don't know whether you had to or not. I don't give a damn. But Knox Persons cares. Come on, Vic. What is this shit? So he's a big-time racketeer in Harlem. So he owns Harlem. So what? He wants to take me out? Let him try. Now, people have been saying that for 30 years. What people? You wouldn't know them. They're all dead. Shaft paused. They stared intently at each other for a moment. He knows I'm here. He knows that I won't go up there uncovered. And he knows now that I won't play games in his own grown-up Disneyland. At least not his game. What's he going to do? Anything he damn well pleases. He always has. That's one of the things that worries me about this. I'll give you a ring. I hope so. Shaft was almost out the door when the detective called to him. Hey, John.
Yes?
Is this right in the report? You're 28?
Yes. Why?
How'd you get so crazy so young? The air was soft and cooling against Shaft's face when he stepped out of the precinct and into 51st Street, turned left towards 3rd Avenue. There was enough breeze to carry away the stink of the midday traffic snarl. He was looking for a telephone, the one hanging on the wall in the coffee shop on 3rd near 46th Street.
Change for a quarter, please.
What? The silly faggot jumped up about 3 inches out of his bright blue raglan sweater and his powder puff sleeves. What do you think this was? Stick up? Can you change a quarter, please?
Oh, certainly, sir.
Black eyes glittered nervously, hopefully in too pale, too soft face.
Thanks.
He felt like a contestant in a Miss America pageant. The creep was undressing him as he walked to the phone. 3rd Avenue, the meat rack. Go to the can anywhere in this neighborhood, and they came out of the woodwork for you, chirping and tweeting. Chef got the slip of paper from his jacket, dropped a dime in the slot, and dialed. He looked up at the cashier. The eyes were still devouring him. Chef smiled warmly, affectionately, knowingly at the cashier. The little cocksucker would probably whip his dum-dum right out of the socket about 4 o'clock tomorrow morning in a frenzy of frustration. Just thinking about that smile. Shaft winked at him as the phone rang for the fourth time and the receiver was lifted. Knox Persons just sat there. Massive, mountainous, a great brown mound of a man in a black suit, completely filling the white leather chair that looked like a vertical bathtub on a chrome base with casters. Everything around him in the big open room was larger than life. The white walls rose 30 or 35 feet to the ceiling and disappeared into the mists of soft lighting. The long, wide glass desk on which he sat might have been a Macy's display window set horizontally on chrome sawhorses. Even the liquor bottles along the back of the 30-foot ebony bar across the room were half-gallon bottles rather than fifths. All of it, from the fleecy carpeting that tamed the floor into a snow-covered gridiron, to the African prints hanging on the wall in silvery frames, was in varying shades of black and white. Knox Persons sat there, staring without seeing any of it. He had been there for more than 24 hours. Occasionally, one of the telephones on the long desk shelf behind him would ring softly and demand he turn to deal with it. His answers were grunts or monosyllabic rumbles from the deep caverns of his chest. Then he would turn back to look out across the clear, glimmering top of the glass lake through which nothing swam except the polished, pointed toes of his classically simple shoes. Instead of the place and the comfortable prospects of it, he was seeing a private panorama that played only on the inside of his skull. A vision of life past and present. The life he had lived and thought he understood. Where? Where? He asked, with each new scene that moved into focus and drifted away. Where? He could not find the answer, and not finding it, he could not act. He could only sit and stare and wait. For the first time in his life, he was feeling pain. Deep, clear, and immobilizing pain. And he was stunned. Where was the flaw? Where? The phone rang, and he almost turned to pick up one of the receivers behind him. It rang a second time, and he looked toward the dressing room closet door at the left of the desk, the door to a place where 20 black suits were hanging beside 100 white shirts next to 40 pairs of elegantly simple black shoes, with 30 white silk ties all waiting, with a slightly antique pay telephone for Knox persons to need them. He got up from the desk at the start of the third ring and moved towards the closet, shaven head gleaming in the soft indirect light, folds of flesh around his bull neck, almost hiding the collar of his shirt. A lumbering giant whose police records described him as a fraction over 6 feet 6 inches tall, weighing 290 pounds, with distinct scars in at least 11 places on his massive body. For purposes of identification, as the record said. On the fourth ring, his huge hand swallowed the receiver and put it to his ear. He leaned down to grumble, "Wrong number," and a voice said, "This is John Shaft, you nigger son of a bitch, and I'm ready when you are." Shaft had two ideas after the talk with the persons. He was going to let loose, and he was going to get laid. "Goodbye there," the cashier sang to him. Shaft leaned over the counter to whisper, "You know where the boathouse is in Central Park?" The fag nodded eagerly. Shaft looked at his watch. "I'll be there about 12:45. No, make that 1 a.m. sharp, okay? Do we have to meet in the park?" "Well, if you don't want to." "Oh, all right. Ciao. Ciao." The muggers and that one deserved each other. He hoped the little fart was a karate champion. He would last about 10 minutes longer that way. Until somebody stuffed his brown belt in one ear and pulled it out the other. Nodded. Cabs were crowding up Third Avenue with women, shoppers, some businessmen getting back from lunch too smashed to see. He wanted a drink, too. A lemonade pitcher full of them. Shaft leaned off the curb and flagged three cabs before the driver of one would recognize his existence. Now the cops were moonlighting as armed cab drivers. It was almost possible for a black man to travel overland through New York. If his wardrobe passed the meticulous inspection of the cigar-stinking, unshaven rag bag behind the wheel, it was such a waste of energy being black, emotional, and physical. McBurney YMCA, please. It's on West 23rd Street, just west of 7th. "You want to go down the drive?" "No, I want to go down Park Avenue to 23rd Street and turn right." "Go to boss." Shaft grunted. Persons had surprised him. Andarazzi said Shaft's voice would shake Persons. He had expected violent anger, equal to and possibly surpassing his own. It had not been there, at least not on the surface. He read it as a tired old man. Limping giant looking for a cave where he could hide from the pygmies, hide and bleed a while. But thinking of Persons that way was deadly dangerous. That wasn't Knox Persons, not the legend or the lumbering mammoth in the flesh. Persons had been shot, cut, smashed over the head, run down, slammed so deep into jails, moles couldn't find him for his lawyer, even bombed. He took the rap and the muscle for providing the pleasures that had been allowed to Harlem and permitted to take place behind the wall of the ghetto. In return, his community honored him as a leader among men and paid balm for his wounds. There had been only silence to Shaft's opening savagery. "Do you hear me, you overgrown pimp?" "I hear you." A great rumble with the emptiness of an out-of-tune kettle drum. He talked. Persons heard him. Shaft watched the iron-fenced center strip of Park Avenue roll by after they came across 49th Street and turned south. Each block was jammed with tulips, each section another shade, red, white, and red, yellow, deep purple. Carefully planted spotlights allowed the flowers to rest, but caught them and held them as brilliant splashes of spring color. Somebody's rich widow gave them to the city. Shaft remembered reading about it in the Times, but he couldn't quite understand it. What the hell good were they as window dressing on a city like this? It was a money city. They should plant rows of sticks with $100 bills tied to them to show what it all meant and stood for. The cat who has the bread is the man. The cab rolled into the tomb-like arch and up the ramp around the sterile ugliness of the Pan Am building and the grubby Grand Central Station. In the darkness, he wondered fleetingly about the man who screwed the world out of a price of tulips in the first place. Maybe he didn't even like tulips. And look what his money was doing now. And maybe he, John Shaft, was freaking out. Crazy. Crazier than Andorazzi knows. God damn. He had to get rid of it. Waste it. He couldn't even think. Shaft considered calling her for the YMCA lobby phone, but he was too impatient. He rode the elevator to the sixth floor, showed the sleepy, slow attendant his membership card, and got a thin institutional towel. He wouldn't dry the ass of an emaciated midget, he thought, questioning the logic of a place so involved in wetness from pool, the showers, the steam rooms, yet so dedicated to skimpy towels. Walking back to the locker room, he caught a glimmering insight into the sourness the day was squeezing out of him. "Keep it up, man," he said aloud, "and about six cats in white coats will come running out of Bellevue to throw nets over you." Tension did that. So did anger. That's why he was here. There were two or three paunchy, bald Jewish business types in the locker room. There were a lot of wholesale fabric dealers in the area, and they stopped for a steaming and a rub, just as their richer cousins did in the flossy midtown health clubs. No one he knew. He had a nodding acquaintance with only two or three of the other people who came to the place for whatever reason. It wasn't his club. It was his escape hatch, decompression chamber. The thought of the lanky man skating across the floor and out the window nagged him for a second. Fuck it. Go away. The vision fled. Shaft felt the dampness touch his body as he stripped and began hanging his clothes in the thin slit of a locker. His body almost always felt good. He knew its value. From the first beating it had survived, from the first club-swinging cop it had outrun through a trash-cluttered alley, from the first concrete chasms it had leaped between Harlem's tenements, from the bullets it had survived. Shaft glanced at the scars, circular puckers of indented flesh on his left side, two in the meaty muscle of his upper thigh, the third in the lower left abdomen. The last one surrounded by the slice and stitch marks of surgery. Maybe it was the pressure of people coming after him with guns again. Maybe it was looking at the scars again. But the memory of how he got them went through his mind. He saw the Viet Cong teenager's wan, weary face peering out of the bunker south of Da Nang, peering over the brush-covered length of a rifle that was almost bigger than the kid. Bing, 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 like that. He had three holes in his left side, and he was spinning on his own ankles like a wobbly top. And the impartial judgment of his own automatic rifle was somehow chewing its way toward the surprised almond eyes. The medics told Shaft he should have died on the deck of the helicopter that carried him out of the place where his blood had joined the jungle ooze. They told him he should have died at the first medical station of his unit. But they told him he was one tough son of a bitch who was going to live when the base hospital surgeon finished the hurried, harried work of relinking his intestines. Shaft shook the vision from his head as he pulled on the jock strap and the sweatsuit. He jogged out of the locker room and took the stairs to the workout room two at a time, a dead run at 45-degree angle up. He had work to do. "Yes?" The word came through the apartment intercom in two syllables. "What is it?" "John Shaft." The catch release on the glass and wood door buzzed, and he pushed into the hallway of the old brownstone on West 21st Street. He had gone around the slanted track of the McBurney gym again and again, swung hand by hand over the overhead ladder like a demented, driven Tarzan, rode a mighty river on a machine that never moved, and gotten up to run again. Until the sweatsuit slopped around his ankles in a mushy bag of the perspiration pouring out of him, his heart thundered against the walls of his chest with a threat to explode into shrapnel of flesh, and his breathing was a hoarse scream. He quit because he had to, stood trembling in the burning rain of the shower, and then plunged into the pool to let the water lift and lave the muscles he had tried. He had to be there with her, then. He could not conceive she would not be there. John, she used his name. John. It was a soft cry, more relief than welcome. I read about you. There was something on the 7 o'clock news about the man in... Shh. She was herself now. The tangerine wig and the purple coat were in the closet. She was a tall, slim girl whose light brown hair drifted in a whispery haze around her shoulders. An almost pretty girl who was instead beautiful, whose lean features had made him think of English movies when they had met, whose body was wrapped now in a bright blue Japanese man's robe that barely touched her thighs. Shh. Chef quieted her, reaching and folding her into his arms, burying his face in the soft, fine hair beneath her right ear and filling his lungs with the jasmine scent of the Guerlain soap she used. I worried, don't, but I... His mouth closed on hers and stopped the words. His hand moved across her back, feeling the muscles and tendons beneath the firm flesh. His cheek also felt the touch of something that could have been a tear from her blue-gray eyes, or the moisture from the scrubbing that had taken away the day's makeup and made her face pale, white, fresh, and shining. She filled his hands with vibrancy, movement as she pressed against him, her hands holding his face, stroking his neck, tracing fire across his shoulders. Ellie, baby, he gasped when their mouth tore apart, and he sank his head to the nuzzling place on her throat, and her head fell back, her eyes closed. She was talking to him with her body, speaking to him from pelvis to the small round breasts against the flat slab of his torso. He was answering, demanding. He felt her hands move across his shoulders and down his chest, forcing their way between them, opening the button of his gray suit, moving inside the warmth of his chest, and then lower to the robe's belt and the clothes that were between them. She was nibbling his ear, biting him, licking him, kissing and urging him. You are so warm, she said. The heat of you. The heat of you. She began to croon it, murmur and moan it. Her arms were wrapped around his neck, and he felt her legs rise and entwine themselves on his, leaving the holding of her to the strength of his hands and arms. In a sudden freedom and finding, Shaft entered her and pressed her down and down upon his body, an impaled figure clinging to the thrust of his need for her. He walked with her that way. They moved together in the single entity of passion, walked to the couch where he laid her gently down and began the rhythmic pulsing of the explosions they contained. Oh, Shaft, she cried. Fuck me. Fuck me. An hour. 2 hours. The time drifted away as gently as old fog. He smoked one of her parliaments and looked from the wide, long bed toward the window of the apartment. The shutters were partially open and slits of light and darkness broke the solid shape of the wall. He was thinking about the way she had moved to meet his thrust. He was thinking of getting dressed and leaving. I want to sleep against your warm body, she said, very sleepily. Very quietly. I want to hold you there and to go to sleep with you in my hand. There's an Episcopalian seminary across the street, its beacons of purity casting light against the blinds, light for the new crop of spokesmen of some god he knew did not exist and had very little to say that he could understand. He wondered what the seminarians would say if they could see these bodies side by side, hear her words. They would strangle in their little white collars. I'll try to be back. A man is coming to my office to see me at midnight. I'll try to get back as quick as I can. She had to understand. And if she couldn't understand, she had to accept. He couldn't pour it all out and try to explain why he must be there for the meeting with Knox Persons. She had to take it. Maybe that message was there in the way he had spoken. Whenever you're done, wake me up. She put her cheek against his shoulder and went to sleep. He did not move until she was deeply into it, gone from the world he lived in.
Context of White Supremacy. So we will pick up Chapter 3 next Thursday. Got confirmation. This is a white woman. The tangerine hair, wig, I guess it was, and all that. Isaac Hayes in the song Shaft. No one understands him but his woman. Talking about this white woman with tangerine hair? Shaft. The number to dial is 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you have thoughts. Let's see. I will get the remainder of our commentary from one of our investors. So he stopped from chapter one. He continues, picking up from chapter two. The silly faggot, the creep was undressing him. The little cocksucker, whip his dum-dum right out of the socket. The homoeroticism, there's that word again, is relentless in this text. I wonder if the author is gay. Now, he was married, Mr. Tidyman. We all know that that doesn't mean a whole lot. Keep it on the down low, blah, blah, blah. His wife has talked about his writing and all the rest of it, but ooh-wee. Shaft. It does seem to be a lot of focus on black male genitalia. Number two, you know where the boathouse is in Central Park. Shaft seems to be setting up this gay man for a beating. For what purpose, except that he may be conflicted, self-hatred, about his sexuality, in spite of all his supposed lust for women. We'll have to keep all this in mind because we have a ways to go. So does this continue throughout the text? Some of this is in the movie. Not as glaring. Well, anyway. Next, number three. Made her pale face white. Shaft is in a tragic arrangement. Sexual confusion appears to be a major theme of this text. For sure. Let's see. Okay, Gus, I'm done second-guessing you about some of your book choices for the club. Given the repeated racialized homoeroticism and fetishization of the black male body in Apropos of Nothing, Shaft seems like a perfect segue. That's what I thought. I did not know, or at least before reading, I didn't know there was going to be all that homoeroticism in Woody Allen's book. But as soon as we got halfway through, Shaft, written by Earl Tidyman, white man, oh yeah. And it's set in New York. Same time period almost as Woody Allen, Manhattan, and all the rest of it. Oh, yeah. Natural follow. Let's see. *61 if folks have thoughts to share. All the folks with a hand up, line should be open. If you did not get to comment the first time around, do not wait until the end. See, Henry Chicago, retired firefighter in Florida, should be with us. I'll nab other hands as I see them.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Well, with the second reader, I don't know exactly what happened. It was some differences as opposed to the 1971 movie. There was a homosexual scene, so to speak, in the movie, the bartender, to me, obviously was a homosexual. He even hinted to it by stating to Shaft about this white woman that was eyeballing him, was paying attention to him as he was up at the bar, and he basically gave a analysis of this white woman, this homosexual white male bartender, and there was a sex scene with this white female. But I would also say, though, and it probably was designed
to attract a black audience by not having him with nothing but white women. He did have a seemingly dedicated black female that was paired with him in the movie itself. And I think that was designed in order to have black people to come to watch the movie. I think that had a lot to do with it. You know, at that time, it was still the popular phrases with black pride, quote unquote, black people, quote unquote, coming together, whatever that means. But that was popular during that time. So that had to be in the movie from the standpoint to be able to attract people, black people, to come watch the movie, to pay to watch the movie in itself. I don't know, the second reading just seems like difference between that and in the movie itself. That's all I have to say for right now. Thank you.
Not quite as closely aligned to the film as the first chapter was, chapter two, my observation as well. Let's see. Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Henry in Chicago, any comments or processing?
Thanks for passing me the book. I had got it in the middle of the reading, so I was following along with some of them, but I caught a couple of phrases, homoerotic phrases. I think you mentioned it before with cocksucker, and I see in this paragraph with that same naming the meat rack. It's pretty interesting. I see that there was a mention of a Viet Cong teenager. I remember you mentioned in the last session that Vietnam wasn't mentioned, but there was a Viet Cong teenager that was mentioned in here as well. When he was on the way to, I guess, this white woman's house or where she lived at, the author described as a driven Tarzan. Well, the sentence says he had gone around the slanted tracks of the McBurney gym again and again, swung hand by hand on the overhead ladder like a demented, driven Tarzan. I thought that was interesting. Tarzan. what you suspected, because like I said, I did not see the film, well, the original film, but this looks like a white woman he was having sexual intercourse with. So, that's all I have on my mind.
Much obliged, Henry, in Chicago. It's been a while since I've seen the one that came out in like 2000 with Samuel L. Jackson. Samuel L. Jackson was also in the 2019 release that came out. But I don't think Samuel L. Jackson has a white love interest. The late John Singleton directed that film, but I don't think he has a white love interest. And I don't remember about the homosexual component. I would have to watch it again. It's been a while. But I watched the original 1971 Shaft this week, yesterday, and the homoeroticism is right there, pretty flagrant, along with the white woman. Let's see. Star 6-1, if other folks have commentary, I'll try to get in some of my notes as well. Let's see. So from chapter 2, Shaft gambled. He bet the elevator starter and the cigar stand proprietor would not want to remember how it had happened. The two black men? What two black men? Got no trouble with colors around here, buddy. Why don't you guys chase all the winos and queers out of Times Square? There it is again. Now, maybe that was a popular grouse around that time. Get rid of the queers in Times Square. Maybe. I've never heard that. I didn't live in New York either, though. Get the pigeons while you're at it. Chaff that the cops wouldn't care that much. A body in Times Square was as easy to ignore as a baboon in a ballroom. Now, that is quite a metaphor. I would think that a baboon would kind of stick out in a ballroom. You're comparing a dead black male to a baboon and saying that nobody cares, and he concludes it all, but a dead spade is a dead spade. Now, Black Lives Matter, that. That's not in the movie either. Dead spade is a dead spade. Like, they... This is there. The black guy goes out the window and all that. The police are going to come and talk to Chaff about all this and blah, blah, blah. But nobody dead spade is a dead spade. All of that is not in the film, although maybe it should be. Let's see. Same scene. Chaff raised his chin from his chest. He had almost gone to sleep in the butt cupping grip of the molded steel chair. Now, when I get a sentence like that, now I went into this, hadn't read the book, started doing my research because I didn't know a whole lot about Ernest Tidyman. Just said the homoeroticism from what I know about the film. If a white man wrote this, it's going to continue in the book. And I think even if you read the description, it's conditional. I don't say the homoeroticism is there, absolutely, blah, 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 because I don't know. I hadn't read it, but I suspect it. I have never heard someone describe a butt-cupping grip of a chair. Now, if anyone has heard that term used, if you use that phrase, maybe they don't have butt-cupping chairs in Washington State, or maybe this is something that faded out. Maybe this you had to be around in the psychedelic 70s to experience this era of butt-gripping furniture, but I mean... This is a lot. We've read two chapters, and it's life. We're reading Shaft. Okay, I mean, the homoeroticism is right there in the title and all of that. But I mean, then it's butt this and bag that and grabbing this and cocksucking it. Like, what in the world? Henry in Chicago says, is this guy gay? Ernest Tidyman, is this a gay white man? I don't know, but whoo. I could see why, if you read this, you might be thinking, is this LGBT, Ernest Tidyman? Was he down low? He had a wife, and then... Let's see. Andarazi counted 10, 11, 12, and wondered if he could still pass 10 himself. Now, we got a white man. Now, this is almost sounds like Earl Tidyman, in my view. He's watching Shaft break out into push-ups. I don't know that in and of itself, there's a murder. A white police officer, a pair of them, they are here for the second time in two chapters. They've come to question you aggressively, even more so this time because you should be a suspect in all this. Why is this the time? Let me break out and see how many push-ups I can break off in the next 30. Why is that? And have this white man, white police officer, gawking, counting. 9, 10. Oh, wow, this is a strong, virile Negro. I can't even do all those. Let's see. Change a quarter, please. What? The silly faggot jumped about 3 inches out of his bright blue Ragian sweater and its powder puff sleeves. What did he think it was? A stick-up? Can you change a quarter, please? Oh, certainly, sir. Black eyes glittered nervously, hopefully in a too pale, too soft face. So this is a white person. Thanks. He felt like a contestant in the Miss America pageant. Those are generally female. So he feels like a female. He feels like a white woman. At this time, they were pretty much exclusively white women. So he feels like a white woman. The creep was undressing him as he walked to the phone. Third Avenue, the meat rack. Go to the can anywhere in this neighborhood, and they came out of the woodwork for you, chirping and tweeting. I have now that portion I have heard discussed, where in the 1970s that they it was difficulties with public restrooms because there would be all sorts of sexual attacks, particularly sexual attacks against male sodomy, that sort of thing. That this was a widespread problem throughout the 70s, and that they even lots of locks and things on public bathrooms and things on the interstate because of this sort of instance going on. So this may be based in some truth. I don't know if it's, you know, exaggerated to what degree, but I have heard this reported before. I've even heard Mr. Fuller talk about this. But now again, this is supposed to be super shaft. Do 100 push-ups in 5 minutes. And I got to go and oh man, I feel like a little white girl. He's undressing me and making me feel uncomfortable. I feel like a piece of meat on display. Oh my God, like what? What? You oscillate back and forth from this and the butt cupping chair to having sex with a white woman who's a freak? Reading is more important than watching television. One of the reasons that we're reading this book is you can look at the generations of black people, whether they loved all the Richard Roundtree Shaft movies that came out in the 70s, whether they liked the John Singleton version that came out with Samuel L. Jackson. Richard Roundtree did a cameo there as well, whether they liked the most recent version that came out in 2019, whether they liked them all. This film series had such an enormous influence on thought, speech, action, and is pointed to this very day as, you know, constructive cinema working against white supremacy, racism, and gave black people something to look up to and an image that's not subservient. I would argue that's not even the case in the movie, but ooh, certainly when you look at the book that all this is based on, if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, you will be cheering and acting the fool watching Shaft. Let's see. The eyes were still devouring him. Delectable Negro, we read that in the book club. What superhero has to talk about? I don't even hear Wonder Woman talk like that. Is that in any other Wonder Woman's where she's being objectified, talked about like a piece of meat? Does that happen? By other women, no less? Next. The little cocksucker that comes up at you, like, what is going on? And Shaft winks at him as the phone ring and he exits. Now, ostensibly, he's, you know, setting him up to get beaten up later on. Like, I'll show you for doing this. But I mean, you lead him. The ruse is I pretend that we're going to meet up later for a date and then I wink at you. What is going on? None of this is in the film, by the way. Let's see. Now, Vietnam, it's like he's in a flashback where he's looking at his body and all these scars, which is also homoerotic to have a white author spending so much time. I think this was in White Dog we read last year, where we had a white author spending a lot of time kind of obsessing in very explicit detail over black males' bodies and features. So he's going over all the scars on Shaft's body and how he got them and going back to this flashback to Vietnam. Which is not totally removed from the film. And he talks about he saw this Viet Cong teenager's wan, weary face peering out of the bunker south of Da Nang, right there. So we get early. And I suspect that this is going to be mentioned more as we continue to read the text in terms of his time in Vietnam, which is kind of placing this in terms of, we talked about, I think, retired firefighter, the drug use of this time period, and veterans coming back where they were addicted to heroin and all that. That's a big part of what was happening at this time period. some of that is addressed here, but that's excluded from the movie. Many movies talked about, you know, this Vietnam and all of that during this time period. I'm not sure why this was left out completely of this film that came out on July 2nd, July 4th weekend. Let's see. We got now talk about segue. Woody Allen talked about working with a white woman who played, I think, Jane on Tarzan, working with her and what, how beautiful she was and all that. And I said, hey, that's this, he, all of these white filmmakers and entertainers that he's mentioning, this is the foundation of white supremacy entertainment. Tarzan was a part of that. Tarzan to come around again, showing how foundational this film is, and that he can use it as a metaphor. He had gone around the track, the slanted track, at the McBurney Gym again and again, swung hand by hand on the overhead ladder like a demented, driven Tarzan rode a mighty river on a machine. Now, we've already had black people compared to monkeys. Now he's Tarzan. Even though Tarzan was a white man, but still, he's some sort of jungle inhabitant. Man, not. And they got him on the monkey bars, basically, doing the hand-by-hand on the overhead ladder. Let's see. Shaft is thinking about all the white women he's seen in television. An almost pretty girl who was instead beautiful, whose leading features had made him think of English movies when they met, whose body was wrapped now in a bright blue Japanese man's robe that barely touched her thighs. Not meant for teenagers. Let's see. Blue-eyed white woman, we get that. It was so much of that in Woody Allen's Apropos of Nothing. Blue-eyed blonde white women, blue-eyed blonde white women. This white woman doesn't have blonde hair, but she does have blue-gray eyes and a pale white face. Isaac Hayes, the lyrics are, he's a complicated man that no one understands but his woman. Is this who he's talking about? Because Shaft doesn't really have like a love interest per se in the movie. We'll have to see how this goes. But in the movie, he has three scenes, unless I'm in error, but I just watched it yesterday, with a black female who's not even named, unless I'm mistaken. But she's on the phone. He says, I love you. Or excuse me, she says, I love you. And he says, I know. Hangs up. It's like a 10-second phone call. They meet up. He says, I didn't feel like a person. I started feeling like a machine, invisible man again. They have sexual intercourse. And he leaves, and then he gets shot. And when he's shot, they take him to her residence. The doctor comes there to fix him up and everything, and then he continues on. Those are the only three times that you see her in the film. In between that, he's flirting with other women, having sex with white women, getting groped by white men. I mean, if she counts as the girlfriend, it's not explored at all. Like, there's no depth to her understanding him and all that, so... If I'm reading the book, I would wonder, is the white woman who understands the complicated life of John Shaft? And John, let me make sure I get that. John is normally a pimp, right? I think 1970 slang, a John is someone you have, you know, ladies out on the corner who are doing sexual activity for you. Sex workers, as they say. Double sexualized name. It can't be Robert Shaft or something else. John Shaft. Absolutely amazing. This here book sold probably millions, probably tens of millions of leather jackets and turtlenecks. Any other thoughts folks have to get in first session of the reading?
Can I be heard?
Henry in Chicago, yes, sir.
All right, so I had to look this up because I wasn't too sure. But 4 months before Shaft was released, Sweetback's Badass Song was released. And just like, I mean, you know, that character was actually a more egregious form of Shaft, where he was basically known for his, sexual prowess and his large penis. So, you know, I thought that was pretty interesting how both of those films were released in the same year. I know the novel was written the year before, so I'm wondering if the character of Sweetback's Badass Song was inspired by Shaft, even though that was created by the recently passed Melvin Van Peebles. But I thought that was pretty interesting that both of these films were released in the same year, considering their characters are very similar in terms of, you know, the only way they define their maleness is through, you know, through their penises and phallus and, you know, sleeping with many women. So, but that's all I have on my life.
Not to get off on a tangent about other movies and such, but number one, Sweetback, get all of our 1970s slang in. Sweetback is slang for a male specifically who's good at sexual intercourse, meaning that he has a strong back, right? Sexual intercourse. So that's the title. That's just like Shaft. Sweetback. Okay. Now that film, which I also have not seen in a long time, like I think it's been a good 5-10 years somewhere in there. It's been a while. It's 50 years old. That film opens with Melvin Van Peebles' character as like a 10-year-old engaging in sexual intercourse, which would be rape, child molestation. Woody Allen was accused of. Jeffrey Epstein. Keep writing Boy Scouts of America and all the rest of it. Larry Nassar. And then he transforms, the song is playing, and into the adult version of Melvin Van Peebles. But that's how that film opens. Very similar. As he said, that came out in March 1971. Shaft, July 1971. July 4th weekend.
Can I be heard?
Retired firefighter, yes, sir.
Yes. I think at one time, as a resistance from the usual suspects, that Mr. Peoples' movie was rated as X at one time to restrict the interest. I guess the efforts, the counter-racist efforts that took place in the 60s, especially the accumulated at the end of the 1960s, black people were interested in our external image. The whole thing about Afros, Afro Sheen, black and beautiful, quote unquote, that sort of thing. And so, of course, Hollywood joined right in from a political and profit standpoint to make money from it. And in turn, I think that has another reason of the movie Shaft. In itself, because it certainly had that, and I would say there's two reasons on why it was so popular. Out of it, the different hairstyling creams and stuff became very popular. I believe he did some commercials. I could be wrong, but I think he did some commercials. The star of the movie. Also, what made the movie very, very popular was the musical artist Isaac Hayes.
He was already a star of one of the top black orientated. It was, I think, white people created Stax Records, but Isaac Hayes was the top star of that record company, and the soundtrack was quite popular. Not just with the theme song. There were some other songs that was within that movie that was popular also. So that brought a lot of people to watch that movie in itself. So those are just some things that I was thinking. But the second reading really kind of like got off theme somewhat, because as of yet, there was only a hint towards on what the theme of the movie was. I don't want to get ahead of anything. That's why I'm purposely not trying to mention what the theme was. But it was headed that way when the guy when Shaft asked the guy in the reading about why did y'all come and try to, you know, jump on me and whatever. And the guy mentioned about, he didn't say the same name that was in the movie of the person, but nevertheless, this person was wanted those guys to bring him to the guy, and it hasn't gotten to that yet. You know, what the theme of the movie was. That's interesting. Maybe next week it will get to that, I guess. I don't know. First time I've heard about the guy was white in the first place. Let alone talking about it. I didn't even know it was a book beforehand. But that'd be interesting on what the reading would be next week. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. The legendary Isaac Hayes. I said that too. Was a part, I think, of the racial showcasing, deliberately or no, that greatly aided in the success of this film. Having Gordan Parks, who was already established, the Learning Tree and his photography and what have you, the so-called civil rights movement. Richard Roundtree, who was 28, was just starting out, so he wasn't really established at this point. And then Isaac Hayes, the legend. He already had lots of hits, very well known, and then the legendary work that he did on the soundtrack, which endures today, absolutely would generate a lot of appeal. And in fact, Richard Roundtree became so popular from this, it wasn't just that they made three, four films with him starring, Shaft in Africa and all of this. He also got a television show, Shaft. Now, the television show was a huge flop, and I'd probably pay money if anybody remembered that. Like, oh, I watched it, because I think it was on for like 7 episodes. And it was a huge flop when they write. If you look online at the reviews, I think they have on like YouTube, they have scenes from it and a trailer from the TV show Shaft, which starred Richard Roundtree. They have a long list of reasons why it was really, really bad. But the first reason they give: no Isaac Hayes, like taking all that music away, and he doesn't have that soundtrack, the pump, chicka pump, and all that, like already started downhill, and it was nothing to do. And then there was no leather jacket and no turtleneck, like nobody wants to watch that, and nobody did watch it. They canceled it in 7 episodes for a myriad of other reasons. But Isaac Hayes, huge influence on this film and being a part of that.
Yes.
I'd even say the soundtrack is a little bit incongruent. I'll probably play a little bit of that as we go through the book, but it's a little bit incongruent to what's happening in the film. Like he says, willing to risk it for the brother man. That doesn't really happen in the movie. We'll have to see how the book goes, but he's employed by a black drug dealer in the movie to get his daughter back, who's been sold by some mafia people, and he's paid to do this. So that's not really risking his neck for the brother man per se. Now he does hook up the black shoeshine guy with $10, and he hooks up a little black child with some money here and there. Like he, you know, tries to be helpful to black people. But I mean, like, it'd be a bit much to say like this character is like a black superhero in the neighborhood. Like He's a private detective. He beats up a lot of black people and is working for a black drug dealer. Calm all that
and
down.
Also, he teamed with a Black Panther-like organization to get the job done, so to speak.
And ridicules a lot of them as we go. Yeah, the black militants are mentioned in the text. I guess we'll see how they're represented in the book. Because we'll see how that comes up in the text. Incidentally, the book, I guess it wouldn't be correct to say it's deviating from the theme because the book came out before the film. So, yeah, this is the template. The movie is deviating from the book in some points and leaving some of this out and all that. That I am very interested about. There are some folks who wrote a whole thesis on Shaft, so I would be curious as to what some of the conversations were like between, I think they had a black co-writer for the screenplay, along with Ernest Tidyman and then Gordan Parks, what the dialogues were about in terms of what they cut out and what they kept in, what they added. I'd be really interested because it seems like even leaving out the Vietnam portion of all this is kind of, You leave out Vietnam, but you keep in the homoerotic elements where a white man gets to, like, molest him. Like, That's.
Right.
All right.
Gus, it's one more thing. This is a FYI. Since you mentioned Mario Van Peebles' movie, I'm not 100% sure about this, but I think I heard it once before. Did you know that a unknown group called Earth, Wind, and Fire was the people who wrote the soundtrack for his movie, Sweetback? I heard that from somewhere. I got to confirm it, but I do recall hearing it from somewhere that the early version of Earth, Wind, and Fire actually did the soundtrack for the for that movie, Sweetback. I thought that was interesting.
I believe that is true. They have so much documentation about that movie, and they have a books, documentaries, all kinds of different projects that go into detail. And I believe that is accurate. Earth, Wind, and Fire doing the soundtrack work, which was pretty standard. There are lots of legendary artists who did soundtracks for a lot of these types of films. During that time period, I think Herbie Hancock did the soundtrack for The Spook Who Sat by the Door. Curtis Mayfield obviously did the soundtrack for Superfly, which came out right at the same time period. Oh, yeah. Marvin Gaye did the soundtrack for Trouble Man. So it seemed like that was a big part of the formula, getting black artists, black musical geniuses, really, to do just amazing musical numbers for these different ridiculous white films of this time period. It seems like that was, get some white person to write some goofy script, and then we'll get Herbie Hancock or, Marvin Gaye to come and, Maurice White, Earth, Wind, and Fire, get them to come do an amazing soundtrack, and that'll help bring in listeners to, or viewers to that.
That's how they got us to go to those movies. It was right during my early teenage years. That's how they got us to go to those movies, because those albums became huge. They were huge from teenagers all the way up to, let's say, people in their 30s and 40s. Huge.
It's amazing music. I mean, Marvin Gaye is one of my favorite artists, if not the. I mean, it's also the 50-year anniversary of What's Going On. And Herbie Hancock and Curtis Mayfield. It's amazing. Isaac Hayes. I mean, the super, the Shaft soundtrack is amazing. Give it a listen. The whole thing is there. I mean, people still listen to it. The whole thing.
They made money was made off the sheet music, to whereas the sheet music was being bought by public schools. I was in a junior high band. And what was exciting to us, as well as all of the student population, was when we played Shaft, especially because I was a drummer. at the time, and the drumming part, you know, was with the, you know, that sort of thing. It was huge. It was huge at the time, and that's one reason why that movie became highly popular. Yeah.
I can imagine back in his get on those hi-hats, retired firefighter up there doing the drums, because the percussion is prominently featured on that soundtrack. So, I mean, ooh-wee, like, everybody knows it as soon as they hear that guitar, like, ah, get out.
Yeah.
Still happens in a lot of places. If they crank up, you know, some of the tunes from Shat or Superfly, any of the tunes from some of those, you know, really ridiculous movies of that time period, it's amazing. But that is a successful formula to this day. I think I said at the very beginning of the program, Isaac Hayes got an Academy Award for his work on this film, just like 3-6 Mafia for the work on the film Hustle and Flow, their song, It's Hard Out Here on a Pimp.
Mm-hmm.
They got an Academy Award too. And I said also just this program, Pimp John, like John Shaft, synonym, John Pimp.
Mm-hmm.
Sexual deviance, rife. Any other remarks, comments? Make sure I didn't miss anyone.
Gus, can I ask something?
Henry in Chicago, yes, sir.
Yes, I don't know if you mentioned this, but you know, I'm reading at the Shaft film Wikipedia, and they said that Ernest Tidyman originally drafted the screenplay for Shaft to be a white character. Did you mention that, or did you know about that?
No, that's the first I've heard of it. That's I wouldn't be surprised, but I mean, that is wacky, because I mean, the first, before you even get to any of the reading in the novel, it says, from the title page, it says, Shaft is big, Shaft is black. So how are we now going to switch it to Shaft being a white man? Like, unless that's some penis that, like, he's seeing this and he doesn't want to see a black guy get all this attention and blah, blah, blah. Let's turn him into a white, like, unless it's that sort of thing. But that is, what?
I mean, that's what I said when I was reading. You know, I don't know how true this is. It probably is true. But I was kind of like doing some more searching on it. And I guess that source came from, actually from Melvin Van Peebles, about, you know, how Shaft was created. And it was originally going to be screened by a white character. And then they got Richard Roundtree to do it. So, yeah, that's interesting. I didn't know about that one.
Stunning. Lots to research around this film. I'll see if I can do a little digging on that. The library is back open, University of Washington, so I can go dig through the catacombs and see if I can find some goodies on this film, because it was so well documented. Even Earl Tidyman pouting about them leaving him out, I guess, of the promotion, or Gordan Parks talking about the film franchise all those years later and not mentioning him by name, I guess, or what have you. I don't know. He felt like he didn't get enough shine, I guess, from the project. But that is amazing. Write this book, and then let's make him a white man. Let's have Clint Eastwood play Shaft. Reading is more important than watching television. Especially television, when you don't really understand what you're looking at. Man, this is a painful illustration of Neely Fuller Jr. like to be looking right at it and not understand what you're looking at all. That is like the millions of black people who have adored Shaft for the past half century and missed all this homoeroticism and everything else. Shaft was supposed to be a white man. Shaft was created by a white man who got an NAACP award for making this character? Folks are good. Anything else they need to get in?
I was just thinking that. I was just thinking that, you know, how they talk about movies and some of the people who played the parts, and how some people turned down the part for somebody. So, and somebody else that got the part became famous. I'm surprised they didn't have any rumors about the great James Nathaniel Brown if playing that role of Shaft, because he certainly was in similar type movies, you know, during his time after he retired from the NFL. Jim Brown, if anybody else didn't know who I was talking about.
That's interesting. Maybe. I do know they mentioned it in the book already that the Shaft character is 28, and I believe Jim Brown may have been a little bit older than 28 by the time 1971. I suspect he would have been probably close to 35, which is, you know, still in range.
Early mid-30s, yeah.
Richard Roundtree actually was 28 on the nose the year that this came out, so if they were looking to try to get it as age appropriate as possible, nailed it exactly. Let's see. The person, I guess you're on the vote line. If you had commentary, you should be with us also.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, guys, greetings, callers, and listeners. I think it's very obvious. Well, for me, it's very obvious that a white person wrote this book. Because just the combination of words used, I don't hear them used by non-white people, especially black people. Like, for example, he used the phrase "nigga, son of a bitch," and I personally have only ever heard white people use "son of a bitch" in my existence. Maybe non-white people do use that word often, but I don't recall it. And I could tell that this white man has had like a blast writing this book. And due to non-white people not really being led to read all the books, I think this book is written for maybe white people, white men who also have the same fantasies that the author has of like of being a black male of this caliber of Shaft, I suppose, being able to kill other black males and have sex with various women. Very, very telling book we're diving into, and I appreciate the study, and I need my line.
Much obliged. The wording in the book, I don't know, because some of this does get to the film. I guess people didn't recognize it, but it has a lot of trappings. If you just look at the script naked with no Isaac Hayes, you don't have Richard Roundtree running around in a leather jacket and turtleneck in front of you, it might stand out more as, this sounds like something a white person put together. I think a lot of us, if you go and you got that, once that, as he said, they get that hi-hat rolling and get that guitar and everything, and Richard Roundtree is out with his afro and Done deal. I will make sure I get in. I made an error. This is important. So I said John, synonym for pimp. That is not correct. A John is the person who pays for the sex trafficker, sex worker to engage in activity. That's not the pimp. The John is the person who is paying, procuring services. That is even interesting to think about. John Shaft. Not the pimp. You don't have people out. You are the one procuring services. I will have to think on that one for a little while. Even with what Henry in Chicago said. Now, the book we just read, Woody Allen said he wanted to be an African-American jazz musician. If Ernest Tidyman wrote this book, did he want to be shafted? If Henry in Chicago said he wanted a white guy to play this, did he, like, was that his fantasy? That he could be like a black guy in an afro with a leather coat and you could be going around and talking cool and singing? Is like, do we think that could be? Maybe we need to read a little bit more of the book to think about it. But Woody Allen did just say that. That's not a paraphrase. That's like highlighted exactly in text. Wanted to be African American jazz musician. Blackface. That's what I called him dressing up, well, not dressing up, but him going out to play New Orleans jazz music. Blackface without the makeup. Is this another blackface without the music? Does Earl Tidyman, is this like his fantasy? I want to be a black male, leather jacket, have a big black penis, shaft. Is that what this is, or... I could be talking bonkers. To say we can read some more and process. See if, you know, Gus is just talking crazy late in the Seattle evening, or what in the world is going on with Ernest Tidyman and Shaft, John Shaft. We'll pick up next week. Folks are all satisfied.
I think that's very plausible. I think he did write that book thinking that he was Shaft. And one more thing, another film that came out that year was Dirty Harry by Clint Eastwood. I don't think I remember Dirty Harry being this sexual beast or sexual machine in that film. So, but that's all I've been learning.
I just mentioned Clint Eastwood. I just said that. Did they want Clint Eastwood to be Shaft? Like, what in the world? Like, that's not even the same movie. Incidentally, and it's been a while since I've seen Dirty Harry, the treatment of black people in that film is something to behold. Talked about that last time around when they were talking about Martin Scorsese. And I said the same thing, looking at and The Godfather. Looking at the depiction of black people in Francis Ford Coppola's films and Martin Scorsese. I said, Goodfellas. I'd have to go back in my mind to get the rest of, I think, The Departed. It's quite a few, just the way black, Casino, the way black people are treated and talked about in those films. You can just look for the patterns. And then same thing for Dirty Harry. But yeah, we'll have to ponder on that. Ernest Tidyman write this thinking that he is Shaft? He was a crime journalist. I left that out. He's writing all this about this private eye detective. He was a crime journalist for the New York Times and also in Ohio for the Plain Dealer. So that's some of his like criminal background element, right? He was writing all about. Probably knew some enforcement officers in all that time. We'll think about it as we read. Anywho, we'll be here tomorrow, neutralizing workplace racism, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Looking forward to checking in what's happening in the workplace. It's for the archives. If you want to write in, for people who are listening in, you can email, ask your parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, ask Mr. Fuller, any other older folks that you know. Did you know Shaft was based on a book written by a white man?
Can I be heard?
That'll. Oh, we had. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I asked my victim of it, and she did not know that Shaft was written by a white person, white man.
Right on. We're all still learning. I'm not surprised. They didn't have internet and all that back then, but you do not. Okay. When you do not understand white supremacy racism, what it is, how it works, you can be duped in a lot of different ways. Ernest Tidyman's name is right in the front of Shanae. You don't get to see it and be like, oh, this is a white man who wrote this. But his name is right in the first, like, 3 minutes of Shaft, big, bold letters. While Shaft is, you know, walking across the screen and all that jaywalking, Ernest Tidyman. And then again, when they show the screenplay, Ernest Tidyman. Even if you're going to watch the movie, maybe at least watch the titles. You're like, what? Who made this? Who is responsible for this? Maybe I need to do some investigating. Anywho, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Talked about drugs in the book that we read here, alcohol included. If you're going out and about, be alert as to what is happening. Man, I was coming to do the program today. They have a sign literally on the road where I'm at right now, next to the University of Washington. They have a sign. It's posted where you can turn off for COVID-19 testing. One of those big signs lit up on the road, like construction signs with it. Am I being heard? Am I being heard? Oh, okay. Yeah, someone hit the sign. Knocked it over. There's plastic all over on the ground and such. Like, man, it is super dangerous out there. Be careful. If someone is being hostile, loud, threatening, you should be thinking that they may have a weapon, firearm. Exit. This is not the time to be confronting strangers verbally or otherwise. If you didn't leave your residence, prepare to kill and or die. Exit. All of that said, if you're driving, you're sober and buckled, doing the small things that we can to minimize contact with race soldiers, badge or no. If you're driving, you're also not on the cell phone. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other Black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of Black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another Black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.